Hello. Hello. Welcome. Hi, everyone. Welcome. I'm David Sokolow from the Center for Law and Social Policy, or CLASP. We are delighted to be hosting this event today to discuss reconnecting justice, how opportunities in correctional education and training can help millions of our fellow Americans move from incarceration to reentry. I want to give a warm welcome to the 200 of you gathered here in the room, and to those watching this forum via webcast. We have more than 700 of you from across the country in 48 states, the District of Columbia, and Puerto Rico registered for the webcast. So welcome to all of you being with us here virtually, and to many more of you watching us on a live broadcast on C-SPAN 3. Thank you to C-SPAN for covering this very important topic. We are really glad, in particular, to see the many participants from a wide array of fields doing important work from many different angles. We're really excited to learn from all of you about how we can work across silos. I want to give a special welcome to our friends from Lumina Foundation for being with us here today, to many different members of congressional offices, staffs who have joined us for their continued and long-time leadership in this field over many years. We're really very glad that there's so many key officials from federal, state, county, and municipal governments that have joined us today, and leaders from colleges and universities, and many policy advocates, researchers, employers, and others with really deep commitment expertise in various different solutions related to poverty, social justice, human services, workforce development, education, criminal justice, employment, and different other fields. It's really an amazing group that has gathered with us both here and on the webcast. We really thank you all very much for participating. CLASP is hosting today's forum because it is a vital part of our anti-poverty mission. At CLASP, we advocate for practical solutions and visionary strategies for reducing poverty, promoting economic security, and addressing barriers faced by people of color. We promote workforce training, post-secondary education, and career pathways that low-income adults and youth need to succeed. And our work on education and training and employment has led us to focus on the particular needs of those involved in the justice system. In America today, more than 2 million people are in prison, the majority of whom are African American or Hispanic. Just among young adults incarcerated, those who are between 18 and 24 years old, 49% are African American and 24% are Hispanic. Overall, those who are incarcerated come disproportionately from low-income communities and have median pre-incarceration earnings of less than $20,000 a year. So this forum is part of our broader agenda. It is the second in our series addressing intersections among education, employment, and justice reform. Last June, CLASP hosted a forum and published a paper on realizing youth justice, sparking a conversation about the experiences of youth of color within the context of criminal justice, racial equity, and economic disparities. In today's forum, we'll turn our attention to adults and the role of education and training during and after incarceration. For returning citizens to get hired in jobs that can lift them out of poverty, the systems we'll be talking about today must be part of a broader approach to addressing mass incarceration and collateral consequences. But just as it's a mistake to train people for jobs that don't exist, efforts to remove barriers and open up job opportunities have to be coordinated with skills training so that returning citizens can earn post-secondary credentials that give them a fair chance at being hired for the jobs that are being made available. So before we get today's program started, there are a few brief housekeeping items. First, for those of you here in the room, restrooms are in the hallway here adjacent to this room. Please take this time to check the settings on your mobile device to stay silent during the event. But while you have your device out and you're looking at it, please take note of the Wi-Fi password for here in the room, and you can tweet at hashtag Reconnecting Justice, and we hope you will all do that. As you think of questions for the Q&A portion of our forum today, those of you here in the room, please write them down, if you'd like, on the index cards, which are provided in your packets. And otherwise, you also can, and everybody watching at home, send on questions to events@clasp.org. So if you would send those, we'll be able to get them to the speakers and have a lively two-way interactive conversation. That email address is events@clasp.org. Once again, thank you for joining us. And now it's my pleasure to introduce my colleague at CLASP, who has done such an amazing job with our team putting together today's forum, Wayne Taliaferro.
Thank you, David, for opening today's event and setting that broader context. Before I introduce our speaker, I want to offer some additional framing remarks about why we're here today. Today, we're here to listen, discuss, and ask questions about aspects of a topic that have become one of the biggest racial, social, and economic justice issues of our time. As you've already heard, over 2 million people in America are incarcerated. And that's more than any other country in any other developed world. While that number is egregious in and of itself, it's even more troubling about who we lock up, why we lock them up, and what that means for our society. For some of us, these issues are personal. For others, that connection may be more distant. But for our society, for our families and communities, and the humanity that connects us, we cannot afford to continue to write off an entire segment of our population. And we also can't assume that this blame does not lie with the systematically ingrained justices that face us today. As you'll hear throughout today's event, the pipelines from low-income communities of color to incarceration are well-documented and rooted in legacies of economic injustice, institutionalized racism, problems with the justice system, and failed policies that have culminated in the system of mass incarceration we know today. And too often, one of the byproducts of these injustices is low levels of educational attainment, especially for the individuals who end up in prison. Among the prison population, the average educational attainment level is 10.4 years of schooling. Among young black men in prison, less than 1 in 3 have a high school diploma. And for young Hispanic men, less than 1 in 5. And in today's economy, where most jobs require some form of education beyond high school, these numbers are even more tragic. Between the lack of formal education and skills among prisoners, and the collateral consequences that come with the criminal record, incarceration essentially dooms people a life of second-class citizenship. And for people of color, those effects are even more dire. And that's why today's panels are so important. To better understand how education and training opportunities for this very population can serve as one solution to reentry success. So individuals can build skills and succeed in the labor market. We know it's not a cure-all, but it's definitely one place for us to start. We've brought together panelists, speakers, and audience members from all levels of government, industry, higher education, legal services, and many other fields to hopefully critically examine these issues and leave us all ready to affect change. I also want to point out that the folders you received today include a newly released report from CLASP that looks at the landscape of correctional education, both from the funding and programming standpoint and also how it ties to reentry. The report is co-authored by me and my colleagues at CLASP, Anna Selinsky and Dewey Pham, and it's currently available on our website, www.clasp.org. Also, the recorded version of today's event will be available on our website later as well. Now I'd like to turn the program over to our esteemed speaker, Nick Turner, president of the Vera Institute of Justice, an independent, nonprofit, national research and policy organization that works to end the misuse of jails, transform conditions of confinement, and ensure that justice systems are more effectively serving America's growing minority communities. Nick has been at the Institute since 1998 and has served as president since 2013. He is a nationally recognized leader on criminal justice reform issues, and we are so excited to have him with us today. Without further ado, I present Nick Turner.
Good afternoon, everyone. Oh, that was good. I don't even have to ask you to do it again. Whenever someone introduces me as being esteemed or nationally recognized, I always think that they're talking about someone else. I certainly don't feel that I quite fit that bill, but I'm going to try to do what I can to live up to that introduction. I want to begin first by saying how pleased I am to have been invited to speak to all of you, to be invited to an event that is organized by CLASP. CLASP is an organization that I have long admired. In many respects, the Vera Institute of Justice and CLASP are sort of the same generation, a generation that was born of recognition of great challenge that we saw in the 60s, but great opportunity to remake society and to draw a greater attention to social justice issues and to give voice to the underserved. Like you, CLASP, and Olivia, care a great deal about racial justice at Vera. You take a lens of anti-poverty work as you pursue it. We have always sort of been in the justice reform lane, a slightly narrower lane, but I think we've been running together for a long time, and it is wonderful to be here. Olivia, I have watched you. You may not know that I have been watching, but I have been watching you since I was I had my first job in D.C. at a place called Sasha Bruce Youth Work. You were at Children's Defense Fund there, and then when you were up in New York as State Director of Operations, and then now in this role. And when I looked at the board members for CLASP, I saw names like Peter Edelman and Joe Onick and Angela Glover Blackwell and Sarah Wortel and Donna Cooper, all of whom I have great admiration for. So I couldn't be more thrilled to be here. I'm going to tell you a little bit right now about what I hope to do today. One of the things I'd like to do is sort of set out the historical context for this conversation that we're having right now, and to help you appreciate that we are actually operating in a moment of history, and why this is such an important moment for justice reform and for poor people in this country. I want to explain a little bit about why paying attention to breaking the cycle of incarceration through some of the things that Wayne just spoke about, a broad array of education and training for people in prison and then leaving prison, is essential and a critical issue. And then finally, I want to focus specifically on post-secondary education in prison, and I'll describe what I believe is an opportunity for all of us to do something really big. But before I get into that, I want to show you a short film. So if you would just turn your attention to the screen behind me, you can enjoy this for about 2 minutes.
We're so lucky to spend Mother's Day together, but there are hundreds of thousands of kids whose moms are incarcerated this Mother's Day.
So we wanted some kids to share letters that they wrote to their moms.
Dear Mom, hi Mom, I miss you very much.
I know I don't write you a lot, but this letter right here is actually pretty special.
Your second Mother's Day away, I took to Facebook and posted. I love my mother.
But most of all, I miss your love. I miss your hugs.
Every Mother's Day, I listen to all of our favorite songs.
I think about you all the time. At night, when I'm getting ready to go to bed, it makes me think of most amazing mom that I have.
I miss playing with you, sleeping with you,
at night.
I miss your smile and I miss how you always used to say funny things on Facebook and post that. I miss how you used to bawl. I can't do it.
I've been having some personality issues. By that, I mean my sexuality. And I wish you weren't in prison so you could be here to help me with it.
School is kind of good, but fighting in school is difficult.
Recently, I was inducted for the National Honor Society at my school.
Something good that's happened to me recently is that I went roller skating.
Mom, I love riding bikes because I just love riding them.
Dear Mom, I will always love you no matter what happened.
And I can't wait to see you.
From your firstborn, Tyshante.
Happy Mother's Day.
I love you, Mom.
Sincerely, Giovanna.
Happy Mother's Day.
Love, Sanaya, your favorite daughter.
Happy Mother's Day.
On the link below to see more love letters to moms.
I show you that video not because it has necessarily a substantive connection to the reason that we've all gotten together here today, but because it is important for all of us who do this work to remember the people who we're doing this work for. And sometimes we get caught up in the evidence and the politics of the moment, and we sometimes, even those of us who are so deeply committed, stop thinking about the human beings whose lives we are trying to improve. And so it's something that I have showed on a few occasions just because I find it very, very, very grounding. So as I promised you, and I should just say that video was something that was produced by Google. There is actually one for Father's Day too, equally affecting. As I promised you, one of the things I wanted to talk to you about was this moment in history, and I would say that we really are at this is a paradoxical moment. We are in a moment where we have before us a massive, decades in the making, arguably centuries in the making problem, this system of mass incarceration that has been argued to us has kept us safe. But we also have in this moment what I would argue is unparalleled momentum and an opportunity. And it really is a true moment in history. So I want to break down those two things for you first. So what do I mean by massive problem? And let me try to put this in numerical terms for you. I know that not everyone here is deeply involved in criminal justice work, and you come at this from different angles, maybe from a commitment to education or to workforce training. But we are talking about a system that on any given day has 2.3 million people behind bars in this country, some in jails and some in prisons. We are what I often describe as an international aberration. This country is responsible for 5% of the globe's population, but 25% of the imprisoned population. And when you compare us with many of the countries that we view to be our peers, so let's say the OECD nations, many Western European democracies, we are incarcerating at a rate of 6 to 10 times more than they are. So you might ask yourself, well, okay, that's fine. Maybe this is a more violent society. Maybe there are reasons for that. Maybe we get a much better return on investment, in fact, than these other countries do. But the answer to that is no, that is not the case. We're investing around $80 billion a year in correctional services in this country. And the recidivism rate two-thirds of people who are released from prison will be rearrested after 3 years, and a little less than half will be reincarcerated. And so you have to ask yourselves the question, you know, why are we spending all of this money to put so many people behind bars for results that are far from positive? On the human level, as you saw in the film, I mean, this affects the children of the incarcerated, and you know that this just imposes an intergenerational burden. But for people who are being released from prison, they are facing what Michelle Alexander referred to as the new Jim Crow, a species of second class citizenship that bars them from all of the things that we need as citizens to succeed, whether it is entry into the labor force, whether it is a safe place to live, whether it is financial support for education. The complex and the infrastructure of barriers to entry back into society are astonishing. I think someone said that there are, when having done a national survey, that there were 44,000 different state or local or federal provisions that in one way or another shut people out of a labor market or housing or student aid or jobs. So it's astonishing. And then we also know that imprisonment has a huge impact on people's income, on hours worked, on the ability to build wealth. So, and then we can go further and think about the communities that are impacted. And as Wayne mentioned, one in three African American men will spend time in jail or prison in their lifetime. Many of these men come from communities that are of concentrated poverty that are increasingly segregated, and so what we are doing is that we are participating in a process that is disappearing men from these communities, and women too, but it is most powerfully felt by the men, and that means that there are fewer fathers, there are fewer partners and lovers, there are fewer workers in those communities, and the impact on those communities' abilities to thrive, to have strong economies, to have workforce, exists not only in this moment today, but just perpetuates itself intergenerationally. So it's a massive, massive problem that we're confronting. But if I could be optimistic and for a moment, I know that's hard for a Washington, D.C. crew because we are in this moment when there's so much head scratching and head shaking about the political debate that's going on or the inability to get things done in Washington. I do want to point out, for those of you that have not paid a lot of attention to criminal justice, that this is a highly unusual moment. Despite the challenge of the work that needs to be done, I have, in the 25 years that I have worked in this space, never seen a moment when there is as much heightened attention to the problems that we're confronting and as much energy and mobilization from unusual people who I never thought cared about the issue as I do, as I'm seeing now. And I think the reasons for that, you know, others may disagree. I think that they're fourfold. I think people are finally just shocked at the numbers that they see that we have quoted from this podium already. I think that stories of people who have been impacted by the system, you know, people who have spent time in jail or prison and are raising their voices and are being leaders in the movement has had a tremendous impact. You can find that in everyday folk, and you can also find that in political leaders. Some of the political leaders on the right who are the most vociferous about trying to change the system either spent time in prison or had a loved one spend time in prison. So that kind of proximity, I think, has woken folks up. I think it is hard to also, you know, ignore the existence of citizen journalism that we have seen in the past few years, which is focused almost entirely upon policing. But what it has done is it has showed something to America that many people in America probably struggled to believe or accept, that
that the system, that the criminal justice system was rigged against people of color, and that the interactions of the people of color had with the justice system were so different than what many Americans had ever imagined could be true. I heard a colleague refer to it as sort of the Bigfoot problem, you know, that everyone sort of, people will argue about whether Bigfoot or Sasquatch exists, and then you see a film of it and you're like, oh yeah, all right, it does exist. And I think that's what's happened with these films of, you know, Walter Scott or Philando Castile or Alton Sterling. And what that has done is invited people in and shocked the conscience and made people want to understand more about what is going on. And it doesn't just stop at policing. It goes deep into the system as a whole. And finally, there's an ideological convergence that folks on the right, whether they're evangelical or libertarian or fiscal hawks, and I think that this is mostly at the elite leader level. I'm not entirely convinced that the folks in the grassroots in the right are fully owning the need and desire to change the system, but they have joined with the progressive grassroots in calling for change. And that is a phenomenon in and of itself, but I think it also makes more people curious, because given what happens in Washington and the state of our political discourse, there is what I sometimes call a man bites dog element to that story, where people think, what? Oh, conservatives and progressives are actually, you know, aligning together on something. So this is a paradoxical moment. Huge problem, decades in the making, but more opportunity and momentum to change than we have ever seen before, I think certainly in the last 50 years. So I want to talk a little bit about post-secondary education in prison, because I think in many regards it exemplifies that paradox. I think that the growing interest in post-secondary education in prison indicates a broader movement that reflects what I would describe as a resurgence of interest among people in the rehabilitative role that our justice system needs to play. I think we are witnessing the slow rebirth and return of an embrace of that value. And there's no doubt that post-secondary education in prison is much needed. You can hearken back just to the facts that I gave you about the high rates of recidivism for people who are coming out of prison and jail. And we need to have interventions that are proven, are supported by evidence, actually reducing recidivism, but much more importantly, improving the life outcomes of people who are leaving prison and their families who are welcoming them and relying on them to come back. Some of those outcomes are, you know, I think are probably well known by this group. One thing that I'm always reminded of is that having completed a college education is what we sometimes refer to at Vera as a protective factor. If you've completed a college education, you are less likely to go to prison. In fact, when you look at the growth of the prison population in the states from 1970 until 2010, the vast majority of the growth are in the demographic of people who have not gone to college. People who participate in educational programs are being rearrested or reincarcerated at a far lower rate. There's a higher chance of gaining employment upon release, a higher chance of higher earnings. And for an organization like CLASP, and I imagine for many of those of you who are in this room, the two-generation sort of bang for your buck that you get with college education is really important, because we know that that children whose parents have sought a post-secondary education are far more likely to pursue their post-secondary education in college than if their parents had not. And so again, looking back at the film, that is 2.7 million children of the incarcerated, and we know how important a college education is to succeed in this economy and the economy of the future. But I think college and prison is also important for other reasons beyond the evidence, beyond its ability to improve outcomes for people. It is relatable. Everyone in this room understands how important college has either been for you or for your loved ones, and essential, and understands increasingly what an essential aspect it is of people's ability to participate fully in the American economy. And so being able to expand access to that in prison, I think, is an important humanizing aspect. It is a way to help people to get proximate. We have spent way too much time in this country treating people who have been affected by the criminal justice system as other, as something, you know, not like me. That's those folks on the other side of town, you know, who we are scared of. But in fact, they are parents and they are strivers and aspiring and want to accomplish the many of the same things that we all do in this room. And so it's important to as a humanizing thing. And the last reason that I'm going to say it's really important at this moment in time, and why I think we should all be focusing on post-secondary education in prison, even though we know that training and other forms of education are really important, is that there is a big opportunity to make a difference, I think, in the next 3 to 4 years. So you all may know this story about college and prison. The 1994 crime bill, which many people have talked about in the context of this this current election, included a ban on the use of Pell Grants, a federal Pell Grant, so federal financial aid for students in prison. And that had a dramatic effect on programs. Prior to the 1994 bill, there were around 270 college programs providing courses to around 23,000 people in prison. And after the 1994 Act went into effect, 44% of those programs ended. If you look at it at the state level, my state, my home state, New York, there were 70 programs that were operating before 1994. Flash forward to 2008, there were 8. So what that did was it took the main source of funding, and there are a lot of wonderful programs that continued to operate. There are people here who you will be listening to who have dedicated their lives to them, but they required often generosity, charity, philanthropic dollars rather than a reliable federal stream of money. So that's the circumstance that we're still living in. That ban exists, except last year the Obama administration did something very important. Even though the congressional ban exists, as the great CLASP paper actually talks about, the Obama administration used what is called experimental authority to essentially test the use of Pell Grants in supporting students who were students in prison, and put out an RFP for institutes of higher learning to apply to be bases for these students. And over 220 colleges and universities applied and said, yes, we want to run programs over this 3-year experimental program. And 69 were chosen by the administration. So for the next 3 years, we'll have 69 colleges and universities in 28 states, blue, red, and purple, that will be educating 12,000 students on a year. And the estimated leverage in federal dollars is $30 million a year to support that. So it's a remarkable expansion, but it is time limited. And that's important for us to know, because what we now have is a window of opportunity with programs in 70 colleges, 28 states. That means that there will be experiments where corrections and education work together, where small business owners in places can find new employees, where sheriffs and law enforcement can stand up and talk about the benefits of these kinds of programs when they are released. And that road will run, again, through blue and purple and red states. And so if you can imagine all of the positive messages that can come out of this experiment, not just serving the student population, but the right messengers who may or may not be talking to their delegations up on the Hill, and talking about jobs found, about happy employers who have an expanded labor pool, about families who are supported, about people who are not returning to prison. You can imagine this. You can imagine coalitions of employers and small businesses, law enforcement and education, locally elected, all saying to their congressional delegations, this is worthwhile and it is important. We are invested in it and we want it to continue. So I think that there is a window of opportunity for the next 3 years to figure out how we can actually overturn the ban and return to pre-1994 days. Make America great again. So a few parting thoughts. Overturning this ban would be great. It would bring education to thousands of people. It would reduce poverty. It would break the cycle. It would help children of the incarcerated go to college, and it would increase income and wealth. But that's not enough for all of us to do in this room. And I want to bring it back to the film for a second. I showed you that film not because you all are a bunch of policy wonks and you know, mavens of good evidence and innovation and policy and program, but I showed it to you as citizens of this country. We created what we have. Democracy was the culprit that got us to the 1994 bill and got us to all of the things that had happened in the decades before. It's a lot of policy like the 1994 bill. And democracy was basically neglectful. It neglected the ramifications that you saw up on the film, the impact of relying on incarceration, the impact on families and individuals and communities. It absolutely neglected that. It neglected the evidence that we know that exists about the kinds of good policies that can actually put people on the road to success, that can actually deliver public safety for us, and that can actually be the spine for good policy. So democracy has work to do here in a different way now. We have a job to do over the next decades to turn back what we have built. And so that's why it's good that all of you are in this room and you will go about your work focusing not only on training and education and making sure that programs, that quality programs are find their way back into prison and into the reentry sphere, but you're also going to have to do something else beyond just being good professionals. You need to vote in local elections for the DAs who are running. And ask them what they are running on. What is it that you expect these guardians of our justice system to be able to deliver to you? Is it more convictions? Is it longer sentences for people? Or is it making better choices about the discretion they have as to who they want to send to the big house? You need to educate yourselves and you need to educate those who are around you about this system of incarceration that we have built for 40 years. You need to talk to your children about it. You need to show people that video and the Father's Day video. You need to talk to friends and spouses. You need to go watch Ava DuVernay's film, The 13th, and have discussion groups. If you have book groups, have a movie group. It is so important for all of us to get engaged, to make sure that the kind of neglect that led us to where we are now is not going to exist anymore, and in fact, that being informed and engaged is the thing that is going to make the difference in the broad complex of policy that we have to turn around. So we have a lot of hard work to do. We need everyone. We need good policy, but most of all, we need inspired and tireless citizens like yourselves. Thank you very much for being here. It's a pleasure to talk to you.
Thank you, Nick, for such an inspiring speech. We're going to transition now to our first panel, who's going to talk about education and training opportunities while incarcerated. So sit tight while they're being mic'd up, and we'll begin again shortly.
Sorry about that. Mute it right now, you don't have to turn it on, so go ahead and mute it. That's it? Okay, yeah. I'm sure I'm gonna mangle your last name.
Van Heydoorn.
Van Heydoorn, okay.
Perfect.
I'll screw it up, but I'll try not to.
No worries.
So, great session.
Thanks.
Thank you. We're all ready to go, and we're going to go ahead and transition to our first panel now.
Thank you, everyone. Good to have you all here. I'm Scott Stossel, the editor of the Atlantic Magazine, and I wanted to set up this conversation briefly before introducing the esteemed folks we have on the panel. As all of you know, and as we heard earlier, it is a fact that people who are incarcerated often have lower levels of educational attainment than the general public. And we also know that that is a byproduct of larger systemic issues that cut across multiple dimensions. In addition to that, we also know that correctional education has been proven to reduce recidivism, increase employment prospects, and offer positive benefits to returning citizens. So this is why this panel is so important. So on this panel, which has perspectives from state level, federal level, institutional level, on correctional education and training, we are gonna try to, in the course of a brisk 50 minutes, address policies and practices at all levels, consider what policy levers can be used to improve correctional education and training and build opportunities, and finally to examine the topic through a primarily racial lens, because that's, I think, the most important one. And we're also going to cover different types of correctional education and training: adult education, career and technical education, English language learning, post-secondary education, and the needs associated with all of them. And actually, before we begin, I just want to thank Wayne Talafiero, who sort of set this all up and did all the logistics and prepped us for this from CLASP, and David Sokolow, who also was responsible for organizing, and of course Nick Turner, who just set this whole thing up. So let me introduce our panelists, and you can find more detailed biographies of them in your packets. So let me start with Sean Addie, who is the Director of Correctional Education at the Office of Career, Technical, and Adult Education at the U.S. Department of Education. Welcome. Next here is Bianca, and I told her beforehand I was gonna mangle her name. I'm gonna try to get it right. Bianca Van Heydoorn. is the Director of Education Initiatives at the Prison Reentry Institute at the John Jay College of Criminal Justice. Brant Choate is the State Superintendent of Correctional Education at the California Department of Corrections and Rehabilitation. And Fred Patrick is the Director of Sentencing and Corrections at the Vera Institute, where he's also working on the implementation of Second Chance Pell pilot programs, which is a hugely important program, which could be a whole topic in and of itself, but is not our subject for today. So with that as kind of the setup, I wanted to start by asking each of you guys, you know, sort of individual questions, and then we'll open it up. And at the end, there'll be time for questions. But Brant, let me start with you, because a lot of these issues are state-driven. California is probably, you know, among U.S. states, among the more progressive in the union. And certainly in its approaches to correctional education. From where you sit, what are some of the keys to California success, and what barriers did the state have to overcome, and what lessons can you extract from that to the country as a whole?
California has gone through some significant changes in the past few years, and there are various reasons for that. One is because we have a governor who thoroughly supports rehabilitative programs in the prison system. We also have, California legislature has supported us in our efforts, a bipartisan effort. And there have been multiple bills that have passed within California in the last several years that have not only reduced the prison population, allowing us to actually use classroom space to provide rehabilitative programs, but it's also allowed us to do other things, such as provide community college for many people. Recently, in 2014, Senate Bill 1391 allowed for the community colleges to come into the prison system and teach face-to-face classes and have that be funded by the state. So we now have face-to-face college programs at 29 of our 35 prisons up and running. And hopefully in the next 6 months, we'll have all 35 prisons up and running. And I also can't forget to mention just the tremendous support that we have in California from our leadership, from CDCR, or California Department of Corrections and Rehabilitation. Everybody's behind it. So it's almost like the stars are aligning right now for us to do these innovative things. It's not that there haven't been some barriers, and I think that the barriers that we face in California are similar to any state, and that would be lack of program space, older facilities that need to be remodeled, just the whole, I guess, the correctional staff maybe not buying into it completely, and that's changing though. It's changing because of our leadership with our department, and the message is we are all about rehabilitation. It's difficult to blame the correctional officers, because here they signed up to be providing safety and security inside the prison system, and all of a sudden we're now telling them you're not going to become a counselor, and that's a difficult shift for them to make. But some great things are happening in California and across the country in terms of people buying into the program.
And I want to move on to other folks quickly, but very briefly, you just talked about how important it is that you've got the leadership from Governor Brown on down. Is this model exportable to, say, Mississippi or Louisiana or any other, you know, other states across the country, or does it require the kind of installment of leadership along the lines of what you have in California?
Well, I think it goes to the old adage, where there's a will, there's a way, and if the top person is behind it and wants to make significant changes, then it can happen. But the governor's office and the legislature has to get behind it, and not just from a policy standpoint, but from a funding standpoint as well.
Let me ask, turn to Sean. The federal government also supports states in correctional education. What is the problem, and this actually follows very neatly on what Brant was just talking about. What is the federal role? I mean, Brant's talking about what they were able to achieve at the state level, sort of independent of any kind of federal support. for the most part, I'm assuming. What's the federal role in correctional education, and what do you think it should be? And how do you balance state investment, both financial and kind of just resource commitment, time and all that, versus federal?
So I think the federal role is to, in some cases, provide education. I think it's also to coordinate education and also to support education. So when I say provide, there's the Bureau of Prisons under the Department of Justice, which they have 122 correctional facilities across the country, and they provide education across those countries. So there's an aspect of the federal government that is focusing on education. When I say coordinate, there is a federal interagency working group, the Federal Interagency Reentry Council, and that is, I don't remember the exact number, between 15 and 20 federal agencies that are working across agencies, working to help people facilitate reentry, to make sure reentry is smoother, to share resources, to share grant opportunities. And then, and part of that is the education aspect. So, you know, talking about Second Chance Pell and figuring out how other federal agencies can help with that. And then I think the other aspect is the support that I talked about. Second Chance Pell, Nick Turner talked briefly about that. That's one aspect. We also have discretionary grant programs where we're working across many jurisdictions providing funding for correctional education. I think it's also really important when we talk about correctional education to think about it as, I mean, language is so important in this field, to think about it as it's education in correctional facilities. It's not somehow debased because it's happening inside a prison or inside a jail or a halfway house. It has the, you know, we think about it as these are teachers, these are instructors, it has the same type of rigor. But that's a quick tangent. But I think it's important to talk about that. And then, as I mentioned with the support, so we also have discretionary grant programs. We have two big programs, which I'm sure people are familiar with. WIOA, the Workforce Innovation and Opportunity Act, as well as the Perkins Act. There's funding set aside in both of those large grant programs. They are ceilings, not floors, so states can choose to spend up to a certain percentage. And then we also have Second Chance Pell, which I think is, you know, it's getting a lot of attention right now, and it is, again, it is an experimental site, but it's something that we're really excited about, and really as we think about building that kind of continuum of education from adult basic education all the way up to post-secondary.
Well, that's a perfect segue. You know, Second Chance Pell is a huge issue, I think, an important topic here, and so turning to you, Fred, I mean, given, and I don't know. At some point, the federal government outlawed Pell Grants for, if I'm not mistaken, to prisoners, right?
For state and federal prisoners.
Is there a chance that we can roll that back? And B, you know, given, well, either way, I mean, they're sort of, you know, if Pell Grants are available to prisoners or if they are not, it's sort of two different trajectories, but how does investing in post-secondary education ensure that, you know, incarcerated individuals are receiving the services that they need? And in the absence of a Pell Grant, can they actually get the services that they need? Or is really, you know, sort of establishing these Second Chance Pell Grants the most important thing we can do as citizens and policymakers?
Yeah. So as was talked about earlier, we are currently in the midst of an experimental site initiative, a pilot program. Those type programs generally last 3 to 4 years in duration. So although there are now 69 colleges in partnership with 100 prisons in 28 states, again, as was said earlier, I think it's important to know that there were over 200 colleges from 47 states. So real interest in doing this all across America. Mm-hmm. And there's a real need for it. And when we think about the impact and benefit of college and prison, we should think about it as a public good. So it's not just that individual, incarcerated individual receives it, benefit from it, but the entire community. We already talked earlier about how many individuals who are incarcerated are parents. And it's very clear that the education of parents is predictive on the educational attainment of their children. We talked about it in the context of economic and social mobility. And the reality is by the year 2020, almost 2/3 of all job vacancies will require some form of post-secondary education training or credential.
And so whether you look at it from a, how do you sort of help renew communities, and when you think about the sort of spatial inequality of incarceration, it matters that individuals returning to certain communities are able to get jobs, take care of themselves and their family. And then there's the public safety benefit. Individuals who participate in education in prison, and this is all forms of education, not just post-secondary, 43% less likely to recidivate, which means less victims.
Yep.
So from the public safety angle, from the economic and social mobility angle, from the taking care of myself and family and helping build community angle, it's the sort of investment we ought to be doing. I think it's important to realize, as Nick talked about in the keynote speech, that this is an experimental initiative. This Second Chance Pell is not the victory. And so the reality is we need to do a lot of work over the next 3 or 4 years to ensure that there's the repeal of the congressional ban. That is what it will take. Until then, we may find ourselves in 3 or 4 years back to the 1994 point.
Yep. No, and I'll just note a certain irony here. About a year ago, we published a piece about in the Atlantic magazine about Angola prison, which actually has a very good under, and I'm now blanking on the name of the warden there, Burl
Kane.
And a lot of the prisoners there are now getting full access to GED education, other kinds of education, which they didn't actually have access to before they ended up in prison. And there's a certain like ass backwards notion that if they could have had access to all of these social services and education before they were put into prison, you could have theoretically avoided a lot of the criminality that landed them there in the first place.
Yeah, I think that's a great point. I mean, when you think about communities that are the sort of largest producers, if you will, of individuals who are incarcerated, I mean, there's a lot to be said about the lack of quality secondary education in those places, lots to be said about the lack of social service supports and other things that a vibrant community would consist of. And the reality is over 600,000 people coming home every year.
Yeah.
And we should shift to begin to see those individuals as a part of a talent pipeline that can very much help restore vibrancy to those communities.
Bianca, I mean, you're at John Jay, and I know that you look at, I guess the question is, given the sort of incarcerated individuals have all levels of educational backgrounds, from negligible to, you know, in some cases, more substantial. What's your model ideally for targeting the needs of incarcerated individuals, given that some of them are illiterate and enumerate, and some of them are not? How do we address that?
Right. So, at John Jay, our motto is educating for justice, right? And so we're really thinking about how can we organize our educational initiatives along a continuum, right? So the core of our program, the core of the Prison to College Pipeline, which is our credit-bearing college program in prison, the core of the Prison to College Pipeline are our credit-bearing courses. But we do recognize that that students and prospective students are anywhere along that continuum. So we begin the continuum inside prison offering developmental ed, right? Preparing folks who may already have a high school diploma or its equivalent to be ready for college level work. The next kind of notch on the continuum are credit bearing courses that are fully City University credited courses. The students are earning those credits. They're transferable when they get into the community. And then at the next level, because as we all know, funding has been really scarce and our capacity to serve the need is really small, but we want to prepare as many people as possible to enroll in school in the community. So we provide access to CUNY's entrance exam across 7 prisons in New York State, so that folks are one step closer to being able to enroll if we don't have the space to enroll them in our program. And we really think about like how can we meet folks at every level or at every point in the continuum. And it's not enough, I just have to say this piece too, it's not enough just to be doing the work on the inside. We also have to think about what happens in our communities when people come home. It's wonderful to be able to provide access to higher ed in a correctional setting, and we want to make sure that people are transitioning and landing on our colleges and university campuses where the full richness of what it means to access higher ed is available to them. The last thing I'll say is that anybody who does this work knows that any educational program, particularly higher ed, changes the correctional institution. Mm-hmm. So while our program is focused on preparing folks and providing higher ed for folks, we also know that it has an impact on the ABE courses in the facility. It has an impact on the HSE programs, such that that community becomes a learning community, and the students who are in those pre-college programs have something to aspire to.
Let me open it up to the panel as a whole, and I'll start with this question, which may be unanswerable or beyond the scope of this panel. But one of my closest friends in Washington is a guy who, in the 1970s, got arrested for robbing banks, was in prison, got out, tried to clean himself up, then became a crack dealer in the 80s, got out, completely reformed himself, went back to college, got a BA and a master's. He cannot now find, you know, despite having both a BA and a master's from Catholic University, it is really, really hard for him to find a job because he's got a criminal record. What do we do about that? Anyone?
So first, we have over 45,000 laws and regulations across this country that are real barriers to individuals successfully reintegrating. They're called collateral consequences, term that I really don't like. It tends to mask what it is. And it is those barriers are those restrictions, those 45,000 laws are really what I call barriers to economic, social mobility, and civic engagement. They range from voting to the ability to get an occupational license in areas such as barbering, to not having a driver's license while you're still on parole. Lots of things that get in the way of our stated goal of individuals doing their time, paying their dues, and then coming home and moving on. And so one of the things we need to do is begin to roll back all of those laws, statutes, regulations that are real barriers.
Yeah.
I think the other thing is we have to begin to identify, amplify, and support champions. You do have lots of organizations such as Johns Hopkins Health System in Baltimore, one of the largest employers in the state of Maryland, who do a great job of intentional outreach, hiring and supporting, and advancing, by the way, of formerly incarcerated individuals. And they have done rigorous studies on how those individuals compare to individuals who have not been just as involved, and in every measure, in terms of misconduct, promotion opportunities, absenteeism, on every measure there is no difference. So the reality is individuals coming home are usually motivated, yep, want to do a good job, appreciate the second chance, and we have to do a better job of figuring out how we expand that.
I mean, this is an N of one, but that's my experience with my friend. But do you guys think, I mean, should we efface the idea that you have to, you know, declare your criminal record? Like, once you've cleaned up and, you know, how do we handle this problem? Because once you go into the criminal justice system, you sort of permanently have the mark of Cain on, mm-hmm, your forehead, and it makes it that much harder to find employment, to vote, to do all kinds of other things.
Right.
What do you guys think?
I was going to go to a level, I think, a little bit more base, you know, really at a basic level. And I think the question that we need to ask ourselves is, what kind of society do we want, right? If we want an enlightened society, if we want a society that's safe, if we want a society where people have the opportunity to benefit from the strengths that everyone among us has, then we have to, you know, remove the F on the forehead, yeah, which means removing boxes on applications,
yeah,
which means, when a person's sentence ends, that there aren't 45,000 laws that operate as perpetual punishments, because we are looking to those folk to bring their strengths to our community. When we use our criminal justice system, and by extension, when we use our education system as an arm of our criminal justice system to create silos that we put people in that are impossible to get out, right? Then we've painted ourselves into this corner,
yeah,
where we will then have scores and hundreds of thousands of people who will come home who will not be welcomed into our society because we've decided that what we want is us and them. And until we make that shift and recognize that without the 2.2 million people's contribution, we are far worse off than if we are opening ourselves to receiving the gifts that they have.
That's really interesting. I guess getting to this, to the crux of the work that you are doing, and anyone can please leap in. What are the biggest barriers, policy barriers to the work that you're doing now, either from a political, practical equity perspective, and full stop. Let me ask that, and anyone should leap in.
So I think a couple of things. I think one of the issues is, and this sort of harkens back to what we were saying before, is separating punishment from rehabilitation. Your punishment is you committed a crime, you go to prison for 5 years, you come out, your punishment is over. Your punishment should end. And really, the time of your punishment should be used for rehabilitation. You should have access to education and training because we know that works. We know that can help people come out and contribute to their communities and pass it along to their children and their family members. But in terms of what you were saying for policy, I think second chance Pell is a perfect example. Mm-hmm. If we had full Pell reinstatement, I think that would be great in terms of changing the how correctional systems think about education. Bianca mentioned how it changes the whole culture of an institution when you do have a college program, because that provides hope for people. There's something more that they can do beyond. Mm-hmm. If they have a GED, they can go and get an associate's or bachelor's degree. If they don't have their GED, there's reason to pursue it because there is something beyond that. So I think that's part of it.
Yeah, and I'll take it even further. The punishment is the sentence itself. The deprivation of liberty is the punishment. Prison doesn't then have to do anything to further punish. Mm-hmm. It should be about, from day one, how do you prepare that individual to succeed upon release back to the community? Mm-hmm. And so we should reimagine prisons that are full of opportunities for individuals to get the skills and the tools they need to go home, support themselves, their families, and be contributing members of society.
Well, one of the things that helps us overcome some of these policy barriers is looking at the research studies that have been conducted, and there have been some great ones in the past several years that, you mentioned the RAND 2013 study, and I think everybody quotes that almost every day. Only two sentences of it, the 43% less likely to recidivate, and that's been incredibly helpful for us in California because it helps us work with the policymakers and with those that run the prisons to help them understand why we need to overcome some of these barriers.
There's another part of that study, by the way, that people should be quoting, and I didn't earlier. Because we're often wondering, are we being good stewards of taxpayer dollars, right? And we should want that. Well, guess what? Education in prison, for every dollar invested, there's a $4 to $5 savings.
Wow.
In reduced incarceration costs. So you're talking about a 400% return on investment.
There are a whole bunch of government programs. Why do you get that savings? Because
individuals don't recidivate, they do not commit additional crimes, and therefore they don't cycle back through the system. There aren't that many programs where you can say it's a 400% return on investment. So at a time in which we care about how we spend our dollars, education in prison, again, all forms, hugely impactful.
Well, I want to make sure we leave time for audience questions, but let me get to sort of the heart of what we're talking about here. People talk about the kind of, in a lot of communities, there's this kind of school to prison pipeline, which is a catastrophe, a sort of abiding catastrophe, and that's, contributed to our mass incarceration problem. But there's a way, theoretically, a way out, which is to have a prison to college or secondary, post-secondary education pipeline. So what, and again, I put this to any of you, what are the policy levers, and you guys are all coming from different perspectives here, but that can be used to improve the quality and accessibility and the salience or relevance or usefulness of prison education. And, you know, viewing this through a racial lens too, which is, I think, the right lens. You know, there's a social justice, racial equality component to this too. I guess boiled down, how do we maximize or optimize prison education in order to get people who are in the criminal justice system, as they come out of it, prepared for living outside that and living outside of criminality? And you know, we talked on the phone a couple days ago. You know, there's a difference between job training, which is crucially important because, you know, in order to earn a living, you need to come out and have a job. But particularly for a you know, post-secondary education, there is inherent value in that, one could argue. So just any of you weigh in on that. Bianca?
I'd say a couple of things. I mean, I'd say absolutely more federal and state investment in education across the board, right? But particularly for vulnerable populations like people who are in prison,
yeah.
Right? So I think more federal and state investment. I think we need to pass the REAL Act and get, yeah, some more, you know, funding for people who are currently in prison. I think we also need to recognize that we are in a moment where, you know, we're deciding that brown people shouldn't get a higher education, right? Yeah. And without going to the places where we put brown people, then we're going to continue to make that choice, not to provide, you know, access. I think on the outside, as folks, because you mentioned when people are coming home, I think on the outside we also need to be thinking really critically. So yes, it's important to have a job. It's important to have, you know, job training. But I think that when we're talking about folks who've been in the criminal justice system, we tend to think about higher education and college as job training,
yeah,
because we've made also a decision that folks are only good for the jobs that they can do for other people. And I think that we need to prioritize higher education in a way that we do for the general public, right? We need to, yeah, see higher education and employment just for the value that it actually is. And I think when we do that, then, you know, you don't have parole officers telling folks that, you know, going to college is not an option for them. They need to get a job, right? You provide more opportunities for folks than currently exist.
I noticed you jotting notes down there.
I think we need, you know, we talk about the RAND study a lot, and everyone, it's the RAND study, but I think people sometimes look over the fact that it's the RAND study funded by the Department of Justice, Bureau of Justice Assistance. We need, that is a great piece of research. I think we need more research. I think we also need state investment. So, you know, if we bring back Pell, we also need to bring back state forms, mm-hmm, of financial aid. I used to live in New York State. In New York, there's the tuition assistance program, the TAP. After Pell went away in 94, in 95, it was removed from people, mm-hmm, in New York. If we're viewing this as an investment in people, and I think it is an investment in people, then they should have access to the same type of resources so that they can invest in themselves. You know, someone's coming back from the Eastern Shore of Maryland or upstate New York back to, you know, Baltimore or back to New York City. That's an investment that a state should be making to go along with the federal investment.
Do you guys have thoughts?
The incarcerated students in California do have access to the state funds for higher education, and I see that as an incredible incentive. You know, there are some that think that incentivizing good behavior on a prison yard is accomplished by giving them more movies to watch, or so they can stay up later, or maybe they have a warm cooked meal or something like that. But I don't see that working as much as providing opportunities for education. And where we have people that are working on AA degrees and bachelor's degrees, that filters all the way down, as you were saying, to the ABE classes and those working on high school equivalencies, that it provides this motivation toward higher education, which in my opinion ultimately creates people that are better critical thinkers. It may not lead to a specific career, but it helps produce critical thinkers with the soft skills to succeed in a job.
I'll simply amplify that. Education in prison, and particularly higher ed, does exactly what we all know it to do. You learn how to think critically, you write better, you communicate better, you learn problem solving. So all the things that we're taught pretty early on as to why you should pursue education in America is exactly why we should do it on full scale in prisons. The other thing is Bianca talked about, and Brant just talked about, how it lifts all forms of attainment. So you have college education in prison, and then you also see greater attainment rates in other forms. The other thing it does is it makes facilities safer. So from a quality of work-life perspective for the staff, and so from a policy perspective, it's about funding at both state and federal level and expansion of education in prison. It's also about how do you support the correctional leaders, Brant and correctional directors, in terms of how do they get the requisite support so that they're not choosing between, you know, do I have enough funding for correctional officer staffing, or can I also have counselors and tutors and peer mentors and other supports that are needed to make it successful?
Well, I want to open this up to audience questions. I should have said this earlier, that basically anyone, I think that there's someone going to be walking around distributing note cards. If anyone has questions, write them down and they'll send them up to me. While you're doing that, I want to ask you, a couple of you guys have talked about, like, we need more research. What's the nature of the research that... What's the nature of the research we should ideally be focusing on?
So we have the Second Chance Pell experiment right now, and there's a myriad of programs that are being offered across different levels of correctional facilities to, you know, just different types of programming, ranging from post-secondary to more career and technical education focused. And we really need to figure out what works for those programs. What's the most effective of those programs given the limited Pell amount of dollars. I think that's just scratching the surface of it, though.
And I think that kind of research is what you need to do from a quality improvement aspect. Let's not use that as a basis for not moving forward. There's plenty of research that suggests that education in prison is extremely impactful. So it's a balancing act, right? Like, you do want to sort of get inside, as Rand said, the black box to figure out which specific elements of programs work better, and you always want to look at how do you continue to improve. But again, it's balancing that need for additional insight versus the need to keep pushing.
So we've got a bunch of audience questions here already, so let me quickly try to go through some of these. So the first question is, you know, it's great that there's education programs and training offered, but what mechanisms are in place to ensure quality? And the questioner adds, by way of sort of detail, I know federal prisons that offer GED programs, but students don't have access to materials or are using outdated materials. So how do you make sure that at any given prison the quality of the education is high?
I mean, I think one way to do it, you know, in New York, the cost of you know, doing business really was that it needed to be a credit-bearing, you know, accredited program, and I think that's one way. I think having, you know, with respect to materials, having syllabi, you know, course material in the prison that's exactly the same as it is on campus, and you know, sticking to that to the extent that that's possible, right? So in New York State, students don't have access to the internet. So there are things that we have to do to adjust to make that possible. But I think one way to get at the quality, right, is really making what you provide inside comparable to the extent that the facility will allow to what you're doing on the outside.
Makes sense.
Including faculty credentials. Mm-hmm. Right? You don't want to just pick up a person off the street and say, you go and teach that person.
How do you incentivize people to teach in prison who have those credentials?
Our experience is that you don't have to incentivize. There are no shortage of people who are interested in teaching in a correctional setting. As a matter of fact, once folks do it for the first time, they're banging down our door to say, can I go back? Because the students are some of the, you know, most intellectually stimulating people I've ever had the opportunity to be around. And so the faculty, you know, has not, they're jumping at it.
Yeah, and I'd agree. Many instructors that I've talked to who've had the occasion of teaching both in prison and outside you know, talk about the level of focus, commitment, dedication. You're not distracted by iPhones and all those things in prison. Mm-hmm. So you have a real focused student.
Makes sense. Here's a good question. How are the Second Chance pilot sites ensuring that their programs meet labor market demands? And this gets to your question about, or to your idea about, you know, the distinction between job training and education per se. Any of you can answer this.
I can jump in there. We are proud and excited, happy Second Chance Pell site. So I'm really excited to be coordinating the partnership between the three CUNY institutions that are Second Chance Pell sites. And for us, in putting the application together, we really looked at what employment opportunities there were in New York. We went to the Department of Labor and looked at where the growth industries were. And then we worked with our community colleges continuing ed departments to match what the growth opportunity was on the employment side with the industry recognized credentials that we were already offering at the community college level that we're now folding into mm-hmm. the, you know, what we're gonna expand under under Second Chance Pell.
There have been also national studies done on surveys with companies that are hiring new employees, and it's not really the type of degree that they're interested in. They're interested in hiring people that can critically think, that can communicate well in writing, and I mean, those are the two major things they're looking for. So those are definitely things, as Fred mentioned earlier, that college can provide.
Mm-hmm. Here's a question about entrepreneurship. How can we better incorporate entrepreneurship training so that formerly incarcerated individuals can become self-employed or come out of prison to start a business using education and training that they received either before, but more important, sort of during incarceration? And the idea here is that this questioner asks, this is an opportunity for job creation, asset building, and supporting families. Is that something that any of you guys have looked into?
I think it's extremely important. So Jackson College in Michigan, we were operating a national program called the Pathways from Prison to Post-Secondary Education. Jackson College was the provider, and they did a good thing. They talked to the students about what it is you want to do, what kind of courses, what sort of major should we have. And what bubbled up as an extremely important to many of the students was the notion of being entrepreneurs. And so many colleges these days offer courses in entrepreneurship. And so that's exactly what Jackson College did via Pathways, and I assume as a Second Chance Pell site, that may also be a part of the offerings.
I know I mentioned the Federal Interagency Reentry Council. One of the agencies that participates is the Small Business Association. And as part of their participation on the Reentry Council, they're giving out microloans to formerly incarcerated people because they realize how important that is to, you know, starting your own business and fostering and encouraging entrepreneurship. So
we also have in California volunteers that come in and teach entrepreneurship. Defy Ventures is in multiple prisons, the Last Mile Project, and they actually bring in investors to do a Shark Tank type mm-hmm. Experience, and that's been very successful with us. And then we encourage our folks, especially those that have gone through career technical education certifications, to continue their education and now get an AA in business. So many of our college programs are business related, so they can now have that as a backup when they move home.
I've got a ton of questions here. We could go on forever, but I know we're going to run out of time soon. So I have one final question here, which is a great audience question. But let me ask each of you, is there anything we haven't covered here today that you think is worth talking about to this community about prison education, what's needed in terms of politics, policy, funding, creative thinking? What have we not talked about?
I think one of the things I would add to this discussion is if you're trying to change your system and policy and pitch an idea, it's really important to understand what the research says and use that, but also get out and see what's going on around the country. And one of the things that has really inspired California is many of our leaders have gone out and even around the world and looked at other sites. See what other people are doing, because there's a lot of great things happening out there, and that's inspirational to us. And you know, we hope we can offer the same thing for other people to come see us.
So I'd add two things. One, I would add that at every point possible, include the voices of folks who are directly impacted, right? So learn, as you know, as Fred was just saying, ask students what they're interested in building programs. If there are folks here who are starting from scratch and building programs, get the input of folks who will be, you know, students in those programs. And the other thing that I would add is really, I hope that what we can do is take this conversation out of the criminal justice realm and bring this conversation into an educational justice realm, into a realm that is about diversity in higher education, so that we recognize that we, you know, can kind of close that gap, the racial gap, the socioeconomic gap in higher education. I think doing that and putting our focus there, the criminal justice side will take care of itself.
I think people need to go to prisons or jails with an open and inquisitive mind and actually see what they're like. Mm-hmm. I think there's a lot of people who have no idea what they look like, what they smell like, what the effect is. And I think that means people aren't really thinking critically and analytically about what criminal justice reform looks like on that level. So.
Well, there's a lot of great questions here that I'm not getting to, but let me end with this one. So, and I'll read it verbatim here. It's great to use data to change people's minds, their perceptions about people in prison, but we'll never reach people's heads without reaching their hearts. How would you, each of you respectively, reach people's hearts about the integrity, intelligence, character, and courage of people in prison?
I can tell you what we've done is you have to take the state senators to the prisons and have them visit, and then they can see what's happening. That's from the policy level, but at a real grassroots level, it's one officer at a time. It's having them attend a graduation and see, hear people speak and see the transformation, not just read about it, but see the transformation. And it's one heart at a time, and it does work.
I think it's that, and I also think it's directly asking individuals a couple of questions. So how would you want your loved one treated should he or she be caught up in this system? What do you expect of individuals when they return, since 95% of all people return home? And then lastly, do you want to be judged by the worst act that you've ever done the rest of your life? And have people concentrate on the answer to those, and I think they begin to see their way as to why how we treat people in prison matter and why we have to provide hope and opportunity and skills.
Sean and Bianca.
I don't know if I can add anything more. I mean, I think it is. I think it's about, I do think it's about hearts, right? Is there, let me look at my own life. But I also want justice. I also want the freedom to live my life. And I don't necessarily want to wait for people to like me before I get what I'm supposed to have. So yes, committed to changing hearts. Really interested in changing policy, because I think, you know, there will be some folks who are close to the middle who we can get to come over, and there will be other folks who we won't ever get to come over, but we still need to demand equity and justice.
Yeah, I mean, there's no good answer. I mean, you have to find the best lever that you can that works.
Yeah.
You know, whether that's, you know, for some people it's a fiscal level, or a fiscal lever, and for other people it's you know, we saw the video earlier. You know, and someone who the numbers may not get to seeing that video might say, you know what, you know, I've been demonizing people or thinking about people in the wrong way, and this is going to change it. So I think it's just using every lever that there is available to try to change people's minds.
Well, thank you to the audience. Thank you to our esteemed panelists. Thank you to David Sokolow and Wayne and CLASP for putting this all together. And I hope this has provided fruitful food for thought at the very least, and maybe some practical ideas for all of you to implement in your daily life. So thank you.
these chairs were selected by a man.
Right.
Do you want some water?
Yeah. I'll have to.
That's great. You got all settled in. And
I did. It was, wow. I was, and I did not see my apartment until literally driving in with all my stuff. I never even saw it. I just took everybody's word. I was like, I'm tired. And I walked in like, how much? Are you sure? You're not going to change your mind.
Good afternoon, everyone.
It's crazy.
Good afternoon, everyone.
Everything. I couldn't have asked for anything better.
That's so, yeah, you're good. I mean, that's like, boom, yeah. Right there, just, I'm jealous.
Good afternoon, everyone. All right. So we're going to transition now to our second panel, where we're going to be focused on the topic of reentry. We've had a wonderful afternoon so far together with Nick Turner setting the stage and really giving us the framework. We're in an opportunity, a moment of opportunity to address justice reform, to address the intersections with racial equity, and most importantly, to really think about what are the strategies and the policy solutions that we need to ensure that individuals who are formerly incarcerated, individuals who are currently incarcerated, have the opportunities they need to thrive and can realize their full potential. And so, again, we're transitioning to the topic of reentry. You've heard many of the stats already from our opening speaker and from our first panel that many folks, I focus on youth policy, so I'm thinking of young people, but youth and adults face many barriers and what we call the collateral consequences, right, of mass incarceration. There's over 40,000 barriers that are documented by the American Bar Association that relegates folks to second-class citizenship, basically. Barriers to employment, education, housing, loan barring, licensing, and those are critical areas which we know are very, very important to just be able to thrive economically and to be able to support your families and contribute to your communities. We also know that education and training matters while behind the walls. There's lots of research. The last panel talked about that research, the importance of it, the return on investment that was mentioned by Fred from Vera. But we also know we need to really think about how those things that happen while in prison actually translate and is coordinated when folks are returning home. We started this day off by seeing a video of young people and children and how incarceration impacts families. And so as we enter to this next panel, before I introduce the panel, let's keep that in mind, that this whole work that we're talking about is really about not just individuals, but about families and about communities. And so I'm really pleased today to be able to introduce our panel. First, we have Vivian Nixon. And Vivian, all the information is up there in your packets. But she's the executive director of the College and Community Fellowship. It's a nonprofit organization that helps formerly incarcerated women achieve a higher education. So we're really pleased to have her. And next, then we have Terry Fazio, who's the Director of Correctional Education at the Pennsylvania Department of Corrections. And she is responsible for educational programming across 26 state correctional institutions in the state. And we have Will Heaton. He's the Director of Policy and Public Affairs at the Center for Employment Opportunities, which is a nonprofit organization that offers comprehensive employment services exclusively for people with criminal records. And last but not least, we have Deanna Hoskins, who is the Senior Policy Advisor for Corrections and Reentry at the Department of Justice Bureau of Justice Assistance Division, where she oversees Second Chance Act portfolio, which we heard a lot about in the last panel, and supports for the department's work on the Federal Interagency Reentry Council. So join me in welcoming our panel. So So what we'll do is we'll have a round of questions that I'll ask the panelists. We'll leave a little bit of time for audience questions from you all before we do our closing session. And as always, please tweet out questions. Please tweet any aha moments, anything that you want to reemphasize to Reconnecting Justice. So I'll start off with you, Terry, at the state level. I mentioned having the need for a strong continuum of education and training while incarcerated, as well as, you know, making sure that those opportunities are coordinated upon reentry. And so in Pennsylvania, your department has received an improved reentry education grant from the U.S. Department of Education, which you're using to focus on career pathways programs. Can you talk a little bit about how that work's going, and what do you see as some good things are happening and some aha moments?
We at the department have recognized that it is important for us to take our inmates and provide them with some marketable skills for them to use upon their release. These marketable skills will help them to attain employment, but we don't just mean any job. We want them to gain a life-sustaining employment where they can help to support their families, have some benefits and things when they're released. Our focus on this grant is working with many of the workforce investment boards in Pennsylvania, and we have a lot of employers working with our vocational advisory teams. We have now regional vocational advisory board meetings, and we are working with these employers to tell us what jobs are available, what jobs are out there, and what certifications they're actually looking for. And our goal with this grant is to take our vocational programs and tweak the certifications that we are offering so that they're matching up what's out there. Many of the employers right now are telling us that they actually have more jobs available than they have applicants to fill them. And we have the workforce. We just need to make sure that they have the correct certifications and skills upon reentry. Many of these employers are also willing and able to look at hiring ex-offenders and re-entrants, as we are now calling them, as part of their workforce. The next year and 2 years of our grant are going to be focused on taking our curriculum, our textbooks, and our certification programs and updating them and bringing them into the type of work that these employees will see and actually do when they're in the field. Many of our programs are old, some of the equipment is old, and that's not what's being used in the field. So this grant is to help us move that continuum over so that these people are actually practicing and using the equipment that they will be using in the field.
Great, great. And then I'm going to build on that with you, Vivian, to specifically talk about post-secondary opportunities. We talked a lot in the first panel about the importance of post-secondary in college. And so, you know, connecting that to the workforce pieces, talk about your work both while the women are incarcerated and when they're returning home.
Thank you. First, thank you for inviting me to this wonderful event. I'm really happy to be here with so many colleagues that I've worked with throughout the years. We believe in a continuum of services. So when you think about the expansion of opportunity that is now occurring through the Second Chance Pell Initiative, we know that there are going to be more people coming out of prison with some exposure to college. And it is very unlikely that all of those people will have earned degrees while on the inside. So the work that we do at college and community fellowship is becoming ever more important, because what we do is create a bridge from post-secondary opportunities presented to people while they're incarcerated and making sure that they're able to connect to similar opportunities in the community. And many things have to happen so that that works. So the first step in our bridge is our Second Chance Mentoring Grant, where we have staff going into women's prisons in New York State, talking to women about college opportunities, both those who have had some college while incarcerated and those who have or are close to getting a high school equivalency. When they come out, there's a pathway that we have from what we call our Community Sisters Program, which is a program that works with people who are not quite ready to enroll in college yet because they have some other housekeeping issues they have to take care of upon release, finding housing, many do need to work at least part-time, getting reunified with children, and all of the other stipulations that are demanded of them if they're on parole. Once they move through that phase, they go into a phase we call future fellows. And that is the phase during which we help them apply for financial aid, find the right school, help them fill out the application, pay for the applications, help them find other scholarships. We provide various incentives to people. So if a person doesn't have a laptop, they can get a laptop. If they need books for a semester, we'll pay for the books. The next phase is called our fellows phase, and that's for people who have successfully completed 12 credits at 2.5 GPA or higher. They get a little bit more incentives in terms of computers or cash scholarships. We also have annual scholarships that range for the person who's most improved in their academic pursuits to the person who has the least debt associated with their academic pursuits to the person who's most community involved. We give about 10 scholarships every year at our graduation event. But the glue that holds, and we also have a graduate program, so it's called that's called College Beyond. Many of our students come right all the way through that pathway from Community Sisters up through fellowship and to graduate school. The glue that holds our work together is really that it's not just another door you knock on to get another scholarship. It's not just another form you fill out to get support. It is one-to-one academic counseling, tutoring, mentoring, and then also group-based network and social capital building through life skills workshops that people take at their will depending on the topic, plus community meetings that are mandatory, where the community meeting is not always someone standing in front of the room giving information to our participants, but it's us helping our participants facilitate each other's progress, share information that they have learned along the way. We have people who have learned how to really navigate the housing system really well in New York City, and that's not an easy thing to do. So why not have that student teach the other students how to do that? The same thing with the childcare system and other systems that our students are involved in. We believe in building social capital. We believe in financial capability. Every student gets financial capability training. We do home ownership workshops because for us, reentry is not the goal. Reentry is a very specific point in time where people should get stabilized, but our goal is lifelong reintegration, sustained civic engagement, and a life that one can enjoy and be proud of and can pass that on to their children and to their communities. I was really great that Nick mentioned the two-gen buzz because it really is multi-generational when you provide education to a parent. And the last thing I'll say, because I'm probably going on because I can go on. the last thing I'll say, I forgot what the last thing was.
Well, you know what? We'll have a few more minutes.
No,
you got
just
it?
Remember, okay. It's one quick thing. Well, we just recently added a career enhancement education program. So many of our students have been telling us that on their way to getting their college degree, they're working in a job. It's not at a level that's really economically sufficient to live in New York City. But if they get this one certification, they can get a promotion while they're still going to school. So we've partnered with one of our funders, and we're paying for City University of New York certificates in both health-related fields and in business fields. And so that's giving our students a boost up in the world of work. Yep. Thank you.
Great. No, that was excellent. I mean, a lot of what you just commented on and really talked about what you do in building social capital are values that CLASP espouse. And a lot of the work that we do in our work is really connecting how you think about whole families, how you think about the parents, the children, the young people, and how do you provide the supports that they need. In a programmatic way, of course, supporting good programs, but also what are the policy solutions that are needed to make sure what Vivian just discussed and really talked about how our program can thrive. So I'm going to turn it over to you, Will. Talk a little bit about CEO. You guys do a comprehensive model as well, knowing that, again, reentry is a point in time, not the goal, and that folks who are returning home are dealing with a whole host of issues beyond just getting a job or getting training. So what are some, so talk about your program, sure. And then what are some of the public policies that would make it better for your program to thrive and for the people going through your program to achieve their goals?
Certainly. No, and I just want to reiterate my thanks as well. It's a privilege to be here today, I mean, just with all of the speakers. But really quickly, a little background about Center for Employment Opportunities, or CEO. We're a national nonprofit that was actually created as a demonstration project within Vera, so we have a lot to thank for that institution, and we continue to work with them very closely. But we connect with folks coming home within the first 3 months of their release usually, and there's a lot of research out there that says that, you know, those are some of the most vulnerable moments in that reentry as people come home. And what we're doing is we're very, very focused on when they come to our organization, they're enrolled into a one-week life skills education course that focuses on a number of different things. But upon graduation from that week, we hire them on as our own employees and immediately provide them with employment through a social enterprise model where we provide transitional work crews via service contracts that we have with a lot of government agencies, mainly at the state or the local level. But what that work environment is able to do is it's definitely about the work itself, but it's a very constructive, pro-social environment that allows people to start preparing for what they need to be able to cope with when they transition into an unsubsidized job. And so 3 to 4 days a week, 7 to 8 hours a day, they're working with, you know, other fellow crew members, and there's a CEO staff member that's working alongside with them. And then at the end of each day, they're provided with one-on-one feedback, you know, about what went well that day, what didn't go well, what was causing you some difficulty, what's going on at home, you know, that may have affected how you were able to, you know, your performance on the job site today. And then we also pay them every day, because I think one thing that a lot of times a lot of people not familiar with this work don't appreciate is, you know, somebody, it can be very, very hard to manage your finances. And to have to wait 2 weeks or even a month, you know, for many of us in terms of managing that finances is very, very difficult. And so being able to provide a little bit of income on a daily basis is something that, again, it just helps alleviate some of that stress that so many of these individuals are coping with. And then one additional day each week, they come into our offices where they have a job coach and they're working on building a resume, practicing their interviewing skills, how to talk about the felony conviction when they're in an interview. Because for a lot of individuals as well, they're terrified. And I mean, I tell everybody all the time, think back to when you were, you know, in grade school or high school and you're walking into that first job interview, you've never done it before, and just sort of what was running through your mind. And that's what every single one of these individuals is dealing with. But after they go through that phase of the program, what we're really, really focused on is not placing somebody in a job, but how we help them stay connected to that job over the long term and use it as a bridge to a much more fulfilling life where they have a much more opportunity ahead of them for a career growth. And so for the next year, once we've placed them into a full-time job in the local community, they have a retention specialist that we call that works with them over the course of the next year to navigate the array of barriers that all of these individuals have to cope with, whether it's housing, transportation, childcare, I mean, you name it, healthcare. But what all that is it's focused on helping them create a more stable life, you know, where they can focus on succeeding in that job. And another thing I often try to say to people is think about the fact that if each of us have to go into work and at 5, 6, whatever o'clock, when we walk out, we didn't know we were going to sleep. I mean, how focused are you going to be on your job when you don't know where you're going to lay your head that night? And that's a big deal. And so that's what we're really focused on. And then what we're trying to incorporate into that more and more now is vocational training and skills. And there are shorter term stackable skills that are aligned up with what the labor market demands are in the local communities where we run our program. Because for the most of the individuals with whom we're working, they have the equivalent to a 7th to 8th grade education, they have multiple felony convictions, and so they're definitely, they want to get to that college education, post-secondary education, but they're not ready at that particular moment. And so, to kind of transition over to, I think, some of the policy changes that really...
Give us one or two headlines.
Definitely. I mean, I would say kind of what Fred had referenced earlier is the number of occupational licensing barriers that exist. I mean, there's something close to, like, on average, every state has 150 of these, and some of them are well over 200 or 300. But, I mean, there's story after story of individuals that have come through our program where they're motivated, you know, beyond belief in terms of wanting to get back into the workforce, and they just run into these walls. I mean, you know, where you can't even become a barber. And it's like, what does your felony conviction have to do with that? And then I would say the second thing is to really just take a look at some of the way our current funding programs at the federal and the state level could be much more effective in directing resources towards formerly incarcerated individuals or just individuals that have felony convictions. So I'll kind of pause there, but definitely more to say.
Yeah, lots more to say. And there's a lot of connections between what you were talking about and the work that Terry is involved in Pennsylvania, really thinking about vocational education and training and career pathways for folks who aren't necessarily ready to jump into a more traditional college environment. And so turn it over to you, Deanna. You sit at the federal level, but you have deep experience doing much of this work locally and in Cincinnati. So talk to us a little bit about where do you see some opportunity levers at the federal level in both funding and policy. You're leading and helping to lead the interagency group that's focused on this. So what would you say are some of the big opportunities, you know, building from what Nick said, this is a moment in time?
Well, working on a federal level with Bureau of Justice Assistance, for one, coming from the community, you have these expectations. And you get to the federal level and you see where the levers are. And one of the benefits, I think, is the Federal Interagency Reentry Council, because that is all the federal departments coming together to take a look at the policies that are impeding within their organization. So, of course, sitting down there is the Department of Education, Department of Labor, USDA, Small Business Association, where each individual agency is taking a look to say, how can our agency contribute to some of the things to increase the probability of individuals being successful? Opportunities that I'm finding overseeing the Second Chance portfolio is the solicitations are a lot of times focused towards correctional facilities behind the wall. How do we change our solicitations to have greater impact of continuity of care of a handoff from behind the wall to outside the wall? So one of the opportunities that we're taking advantage of in 2017 is strategically writing our solicitations for what we want correctional facilities to do. No longer opening it up to say, tell us how you could do a recidivism reduction. You can still have the plan, but these are some of the elements we want to see in place. We want to see people leave prison with a state ID. We want to see people leave enrolled in Medicaid if you're a Medicaid-eligible state. There's a waiver for food stamp eligibility. We want people enrolled in food stamps when they leave prison and not have to wait and be hungry for 30 days on the outside. There's another rule where individuals who get Social Security disability, you can be eligible and approved 90 days before release. We need to start implementing those. So using our grant funding opportunities to be able to impact some of that change that we want to see that can actually doesn't cost to do, it's actually collaboration and having states replicate what the federal government is doing as well.
No, excellent, excellent. A lot of what we heard in the first panel, what we know to be true, is that while we're focused on education and training, the housing issue, food issue, and so forth, is a huge barrier to just becoming stable in your point in time of reentry. And so leveraging at the discretionary level, at the federal level, is very important. So I want to turn a little bit. We talked about this in the last panel, and of course, CLASP work in this space is about lifting folks out of poverty, but also making sure we have an explicit racial justice, racial equity lens. And so we'll start with you, Vivian. When we talk about universal policies, sometimes we miss the importance of drilling down and talking about specific individuals, especially folks of color. And so you're working with women who, African-American and Latino women who are disproportionately living in poverty, who have increased consequences of having criminal records. And so how does the intersection of race and gender play into your work, and how do you see it affecting families and communities?
How much time do I have?
Well, we agreed on 2 to 3 minutes, okay. You know.
So I just for a little context about, you know, how, yeah, I look at this issue. And, you know, sometimes these are hard conversations to have. Having conversations about race in America is hard because, on the one hand, we have done so much. We have made so much progress. We have so much more inclusion. But in many ways, we're still a very segregated society. We're segregated by neighborhoods. Sunday morning is the most segregated hour of the week. Despite the progress we've made, I think there's a way that we have been conditioned to view what's expected of people of color. So just remember, like, people of color, historically, their role in this country was to provide a low-cost workforce. And over the years, that has taken different forms, right? From slavery all the way through Reconstruction and through industrialization, which, when that phased out, caused a big problem, a big gap in low-wage employment for this population, which kind of fed into ghettos and prisons. But we still talk about people coming out of prison largely because they're people of color, in terms of what we need for them to do is work. Everybody making that connection? So it impacts the way we do our work because we teach women not only to refocus their value as human beings from their own center, not from what's expected of them from our society. One of the first questions we ask women who come to us is, before you got in trouble, however you got in trouble, whether you were wrongfully convicted or not, before that happened, what did you want for yourself? You know, not here's the program and here's what you have to learn how to do. It's, what do you want? What do you want to do? What's a fulfilling life look like to you? And that traditionally has not been the way we have dealt with people of color in this country. We also believe in political engagement. So we have a whole advocacy component to our work. We engage our students to work to restore the REACT, the REAL Act. We engaged our students to help get the State University of New York take the question off their admissions application. That is a very empowering experience. So now you have women of color learning, hey, I can actually impact what happens to me and my family. I can be engaged in a way that I'm not just fighting for my everyday life on the street, but I am fighting for justice for all of my people. That's a hugely empowering framework in which to do this type of work.
Okay, all right. So now that you've set us off on that question, Will, I'm wondering, I'm gonna turn it to you to add, because I know CEO's framework is empowered in communities and you're lifting up your policy lessons through there, but it's also very much aligned to what Vivian was saying.
No, definitely. I think there's 2 points that I'd like to kind of inject into this conversation. I mean, one, you know, I joined CEO in January, and my position didn't exist before then. I mean, they had definitely engaged in the policy arena at different times. But when the board of directors approved a new 5-year plan at the end of last year, they created this position because while CEO will always remain a direct services organization and, you know, working within communities, you know, regardless of how much we grow and all of the other nonprofits that work in the same space that we do could grow, our ability to actually, you know, change this, you know, problem and just eradicate it is limited. We can't reach everybody. And there is going to need to be significant policy shifts on a huge level to really, reverse all of what, you know, a lot of what Vivian has been talking about. And so that's really where a lot of what I do now is thinking about how do we use CEO's program as a platform to better inform more effective policy change and systems change at the federal, state, local level. And I think, you know, where I spend a lot of time working with, you know, government officials in WIOA and looking at how the workforce system can be much more effective. You know, I think Pennsylvania is a great example of when they developed their state WIOA plan, they had agency heads from, you know, Department of Labor, Department of Human Services, but Department of Corrections was there at the table. And one of the biggest things that's allowed us to be more effective and grow within that state is that the state actually required local workforce boards to use between 5 and 10% of their funding to run transitional jobs programs. And it's proven that transitional jobs programs can be a huge bridge to get people connected into that workforce, but then that's just a starting point. And it can be how they can then continue to build from there. But that took leadership. But, you know, I think the other thing that really, I want, you know, just to kind of speak more to, I think, of what Vivian is also saying here, you know, a big reason that I came to CEO and have been involved in this work is this coming February will be 10 years since I was convicted of a felony. And when I sit down and talk about my trajectory to that plea hearing and what has happened in the 10 years since then, compared with so many of the participants that we work with, and even a few days ago when I was in Chicago talking to somebody that's in a similar reentry program to what we do, their paths are so different than what I experienced in so many ways. And a lot of that is because of the fact that I was blessed to be born in a different zip code, you know, and I could just go on from there. But, you know, somebody, I've heard this on a couple of occasions, but somebody said it again, you know, just a few days ago in Chicago where I was, is that you're almost better off being guilty and rich than innocent and poor in this country. And it, I mean, we have to do something about that. It's not, I mean, it's just, it's an obligation that every one of us should wake up every day determined to fix. And so I just, my own personal story, and there's many other of those out there, but it's just that difference in what those journeys are is just not what we want this country to be about.
Thank you, Will, for sharing your story. And we know we have the data to show. You go in this door and you're a person of color, you get this particular treatment. You go in this door and you're not, and you're benefiting from white privilege, you get a different opportunity. And so we all need to work together. And I want to turn to you, Terry, to talk a little bit about intersectionality in a different way and thinking about also age. I know your work, much of your reentry work in the grant you were talking about, talks about young adults and how important is it to focus on young adults, especially communities, young people of color, and ensuring that they get on the right career path as they're coming home as well.
In Pennsylvania, we have a very large youthful offender population within our adult institutions. And 10 of our institutions are designated for those that are under 21 but tried as adults and convicted as adults. In these institutions, all of our staff members are certified within the Department of Ed, and we offer all types of education from that beginning ABE level and ELL, ESL, all the way up through any of these vocational training programs once they have reached their goal of either a GED, or in Pennsylvania, we also have a Commonwealth Secondary Diploma Program. We have worked with our Department of Education, and we work with the individuals. We get their transcripts from school, their high schools where they may have been, plus a lot of our programs are certified with Department of Ed, and we do a combination of those that they earned plus ours, and we actually get them a Commonwealth Secondary Diploma Program. And this diploma is recognized within Pennsylvania now by many of the employers as being the equivalent of a high school diploma or a GED. So it is important for these youth to get that piece of credential first. And now we also work a lot with our education guidance counselors, and we're looking at different career aptitude tests to help form pathways for them. Find out what they want to do with their lives, much like Vivian is saying, not just we're telling them what they have to do with their lives, but what they want to do and getting them into the correct vocational programming, training. We are working now and using a little bit of the second chance Pell Grant, so we are introducing back into our system some of the post-secondary courses. But this is giving them a taste of what it would be like to do some of these classes on the outside. We've also traditionally in Pennsylvania not transferred inmates from institution to institution for different programs, and we are looking at pulling that back and tweaking that a little bit so that when someone does attain their high school diploma or GED, we give them that aptitude test. We find that it's a vocational program that maybe not in the prison that they're in. We are starting to transfer them for vocational programming to get them what they need when they're out there.
Thanks, Terry. And I'll turn it over to you now to just talk a little bit of how can we, you know, tap into how the federal government can be more intentional about applying a racial equity lens, about thinking about gender, and also about thinking about the important age and developmental needs that Terry mentioned, you know, given that they have so many of their incarcerated population as youthful young people serving adult sentences.
Yeah. First, I want to say thank you, Will, for acknowledging that, because a lot of times, even on a federal level, with our grant funding, we create policies or funding opportunities as if everybody on a playing field is equal. We're not deliberately saying youthful offenders between the ages of 18 to 24, here are direct funding to help support what those individual needs are of those individuals who are in that age group. Or even saying that communities that are black and brown communities are having a greater impact, and these are some of the things that are lacking that put them at a deficit even before going into the prison system, let alone coming out. So a lot of times if we create our solicitations or our policies as if everyone is starting at the same starting point, we're gonna keep coming back to this place of having to readjust. Until we get very courageous and very deliberate about saying, here are specific funding opportunities or here are specific things that need to assist this population so that they can have equity in education, they can have equity in the job market. But I have to say, through this leadership, we're getting there. We just have to move a little harder. And I think innovation, visionary, having individuals at the table who have, the courage to say, you know, we're doing this, we're doing some great work, but now it's time to be deliberate so we can have a greater impact in what we're doing. So basically that taxpayers are getting the impact, a bang for the dollar, because we're supposed to be good stewards of money. So again, in my position, just taking it a little step further to say, how do we help youthful offenders? How do we help individuals of black and brown communities? How do we help women? Because a lot of times we still do a cookie cutter approach, even from a policy level.
Okay, that's a really good point. And I'm gonna turn it over to an open question before we have audience questions. You know, a lot of people talk about, does a rising tide lift all boats, right? Do universal policies work for targeted populations? And so we all grapple with that. So what I'm hearing from all of you here is that's not the case. And that we really have to really think about, you know, placing the how do we support investments and policies that support social capital first and really communities grappling with all of these issues, but ensuring that state and federal investments and policies, you know, are nested around all of that. And so I'm gonna turn it over to an open question to everyone. So we've talked about challenges. We've already hit on solutions because this is a solution-centered crowd here. And we've talked about some of the silos. And so if each of you could leave us with one, maybe two, changes that would bolster a more collaborative or comprehensive solutions that would improve the re-entry point in time of education and employment outcomes.
And I will be very brief. And so you mentioned the way we think about the rising tide lifting all boats. except if the boats that have holes in them. Mm-hmm. Right. And so I think one of the things that we can do is find out where those holes are and plug them and understand the interconnectedness with criminal justice policy, health policy, education policy, housing policy, all of these, labor force policy, these are all very interconnected. And the Federal Reentry Council was a brilliant idea because it helps those different components talk to each other. The one thing that I would like to see done at the federal level is for there to be more flexibility in the solicitations for innovation, for things that are working on the local level to be able to be scaled up. So one way to do that is to replicate programs like CEO that has multiple sites across the country. Another way to do that is to find out what's really working and then teach other organizations that won't have to lose their own identity, but learn how to do what we do within your organization. You don't have to be a clone of us, but there's some tools we can give you. We just started a technical assistance program at College and Community Fellowship, and we're putting out an RFP to anybody who wants to learn how to work with re-entering college students, because there are very specific things that we do that are not commonly done in the re-entry sphere. So there are many ways to implement good practices going forward. Some of it is at the policy level, some is more at the technical assistance level, but we need to understand that it's interconnected. It is not separate from all of the other social policies. It's not separate from poverty. It's not separate from healthcare or education. Criminal justice is infused in every area of our society, and we need to treat it as such.
Okay, Terry.
One of the disconnects with our system had always been that we could provide all the services and training and everything to our offenders while they're in there, but when they transition out and go into our community correction centers, halfway houses, there's always a disconnect. We never knew what they were doing. There was no communication in between. We have now started to work a lot closer with the Bureau of Community Corrections, and we're ensuring that everything that our inmates got when they were with us, certifications, diplomas, anything like that, our systems are now talking to each other and we're providing that information. We have open communication where they can call me if I'm sitting there and I will provide them with anything that I have. And we are starting to make that connect where we can work, continue to provide some help and some services to the inmate upon release and helping them make that next step beyond the community correction center out into the actual world and living on their own. But it did require, and you know, it still requires more policy change on our side, but it is something that we need to improve a little more, but it's starting to improve.
Excellent. Will?
So I think two things is one, as we think about how to write change policy at any level, is just keep the humanity of the problem front facing in front of us. And you know, there's a mantra that's in CEO, and it's not just unique to us, but it's sort of the idea that there's the right program for the right person at the right time. You know, we're all unique individuals, and I think, as your point, Deanna, is that, you know, government can be hugely impactful, but it's oftentimes also a very blunt instrument, and we just need to constantly come back to what individuals need. And then I think, secondly, just to reiterate something that Vivian said, is, you know, like the Second Chance Act, I think has done a lot of great things in sort of providing funding for a lot of programs across the country. And you know, the reauthorization is before Congress right now. But going a step further, and when we find programs that we know work and there's evidence to back that up, be more intentional about providing a pool of funding that helps them scale and really replicate across the country instead of just, you know, thinking about we want to keep trying new and ideas. We need to do that, but we also need to grow the ones that we know work.
Deanna?
Well, for me, it's really simple. If we're making policies about individual lives, the individual whose lives we're talking about need to be at the table. Mm-hmm. We can't make decisions and policies without having formerly incarcerated individuals at the table telling us the policies that are impacting their lives. If we don't have the experience, they can bring an intimate, another look at this that none of us at that table can take a look at because we have not experienced or walked through what they've walked through. So for me, I'm always pushing on our advisory committees and different things. Deanna, who are you recommending, is always a formerly incarcerated individual. If we're gonna make a decision about the lives of individuals who have experienced this, the people who experienced it need to be at the table.
Great, great. So we have a number of questions. We'll be able to get to a few of them. But we heard a lot of themes that were reinforced here. Supporting innovation, rolling back what we know hasn't worked, you know, over the last several decades, even more than that, as you talked to us about, Vivian. Centering the voices and the folks who are mostly impacted, who have been impacted into our work, not just our programmatic work, but into our policy work, and really thinking about the role of and interactions with state and federal and local policy and programs. And so turn it over to some of the questions here. How do we ensure that government at all levels, in state and federal, are working together to achieve progress and a common agenda? You're one example of that with the Interagency Council. But who wants to take this?
I can jump real quick. I'll go back to the Pennsylvania example, Terry's sitting right here, but I think a lot of the progress that CEO has been able to make within that state, and right now we're just operating in Philadelphia, but we're gonna be, a new program site will be opening up within the next few months in Pittsburgh, and then we hope to replicate even further. But there is real leadership at a number of different levels in that state administration, I think, that's allowed programs and funding to be, pulled together in some innovative ways. And, a large part of what's allowing us to open the site in Pittsburgh is we're being able to take funding from the federal SNAP employment training program and pairing that up with WIOA funding, and both of those start at the federal level, but the states are allowed considerable latitude in how they administer those programs. And I think the more that we can have sort of the, maybe uncommon allies together in a room where they don't necessarily think that they should or could be working together, but when everybody gets in that room, you all of a sudden see the overlap and mm-hmm. how you could integrate and work together, I think is where some of the real magic could happen.
Yep, that's a perfect example of what you were saying, how criminal justice policy intersects with every other particular piece, because you're talking about workforce, mm-hmm. you're talking about, food policy, and here we're talking about justice reform, so it's a perfect example. Terry, you have anything else to add about working together at the state with some of your counterparts?
As Will was saying, our secretary and our executive deputy secretary are extremely supportive of all of the reentry efforts that occur. It's not the traditional way that DOC had always run in the past, so them working with a lot of the different other agencies and branches, from Department of Ed to Human Services, all of them combined together have come together and pulled a lot of really good initiatives and programs, which are starting to affect the funding that's coming in for us.
Okay. So this is an interesting question. So and anyone could feel free to take this. What are your reactions or solutions to research that has shows that ban the box efforts are actually increasing discrimination against African American workers? Or we can open it up more broadly. How can we make the ban the box efforts, both in the workforce sector, as well as in the higher education sector, more effective?
Yeah, so I want to flesh that out a little bit, why that conversation is happening. People are saying that because employers are being encouraged to not ask about criminal history at the front end of an application process, they are finding other ways, even through written applications or emailed applications, to try to decipher the ethnicity of the applicant. And if they can easily decipher, in their minds, the ethnicity of an applicant, they will make assumptions about that person's criminal history so that people aren't even getting a foot in the door. I'm just not sure of the validity of the concept.
But I don't think that's a reason to put the box back.
Yes, of course. So more broadly, how can we make the Ban the Box efforts more effective to connect to the work that you all are doing?
Ban the Box efforts need to be connected to actual state and local policy that disallows the discrimination against people who have criminal records. And you know, employees just need to be held accountable for diversity in their workspaces. Because employers cannot start throwing out all applications from black people. They just can't. Because eventually the workforce is going to be, you know, so devoid of diversity that, you know, they're going to get themselves in trouble. So I don't think it's as big of a problem as people are imagining that it is. I think enforcement, by having backup laws like the law we have in New York State, Article 23A, I think it's of the employment law that prevents employers from blanket discrimination.
Mm-hmm. Anybody else? Yes.
Well, I think, and I agree with Ms. Vivian, that individuals who are fearful of change and who are not for Ban the Box are the ones that are speaking on this. And I have to say that when you allow an applicant, everybody to be equal coming through the door, being evaluated based on their knowledge, skills, and abilities, in a competitive workforce, the person who makes it to the interview, who makes it to the offer, is the best candidate for the job. Now, if they have a felony conviction, that's when you have to look at the EEOC guidelines of what the conviction has to do with the job in relation to the job and what has they done. And I share that to say, because even on this job, coming into this position, when President Obama banned the box, I was convicted of a felony in 1998. But I made it through the federal government based on knowledge, skills, and abilities of what I brought to the position through a competitive process in the federal government. And once my felony came up, my felony had nothing to do with the job that I was getting ready to perform. Mm-hmm. When it was all said and done, individuals are looking for the best candidate to carry out the job. And I just happened to bring some extra skills that actually made it pretty good. I want to say that with fair hiring policies behind Ban the Box, it created employment laws that do not allow individuals to have that blanket policy. But like Ms. Vivian said, workforce, it all will be exposed. But I haven't bought into it at this point, mm-hmm. Until some more research comes out to prove it wrong.
Will, anything to add with connections with WIOA and the pipelines that you guys are building and how Philadelphia is one of those Ban the Box cities, and are you thinking about connecting those particular policies and opportunities?
No, we think about this all the time at CEO, and you know, it was a little bit before I came, but you know, in New York City, we are celebrating the 1-year anniversary of the Fair Chance Act, and you know, that went a step further in terms of not just government positions but all positions. And you know, it was kind of presented a conundrum for CEO because the name recognition of our organization in New York City is so just, you know, in there that, you know, when we're calling up employers where they're, you know, looking for employees and we're starting to match up our participants, most employers know that we're actually working with folks that have some type of criminal history. So it's, you know, we're almost just by the fact we're getting on the phone crossing over what the law is intended to not allow to happen in the first place. But what I would just say is, you know, I mean, there, I think, you know, there's a lot of great resources out there that have looked at these two most recent studies, you know, that have kind of presented this new element, you know, part of the conversation. But I think we need to really be looking beyond just the box. Mm-hmm. And what this is I really appreciate the fact that this has, you know, spurred this much conversation about this issue. You know, kind of to what some of our previous speakers had said about this is a unique moment where there's a lot of attention on this. And for us, what we're more focused on is how can we work with employers, big and small, across the country? And you know, and right now we work mostly with smaller businesses, but to think about how are you changing your own hiring policies and practices to better reflect a more inclusive, you know, hiring procedure? And you know, going just beyond that first step at the door, I mean, yes, it's critically important, but it's just rethinking you know, that stigma that is associated with that felony conviction from the very, very most basic, you know, thinking.
Mm-hmm. Okay. So I think we have time for one more question. I'll direct it to you, Terry, and have everyone else jump in. So in addition to the work that you guys are doing with your workforce boards, doing credentialing and setting up career pathways, do you also connect folks to substance abuse or drug treatment or recovery services? We know that that is an issue that permeates much of society, but especially formerly incarcerated individuals, and even thinking about mental health needs.
All of our correctional institutions have a multitude of different type of treatment programs in them, and many of the inmates are required to attend AA or NA, anger management, different programs like that. Those run side by side in conjunction with our education programs, and we actually work very well together within the institutions, where they can be dismissed from class for an hour to attend a certain group or program that they have to attend, and then they come back to school and vice versa. They have ample need to a lot of the mental health. They are identified, and we have a lot of mental health programs. A lot of our employees actually go through mental health first aid training, and we have CIT, critical incident training, to learn how to deal with the different items and things that may happen if we have students in the classrooms that do have mental health issues. But each of our institutions does have the availability for all types of treatment programs as well as education programs, and we work side by side in conjunction, and those programs do continue on the outside should they be released to the community correction centers or the Bureau halfway houses, different things like that.
Okay. Through the Department of Corrections or through another agency that you're coordinating with?
Most of ours are through the Department of Corrections. We have a couple of them that are contracted within the state, but most are Department of Corrections run, and the employees are Department of Corrections employees.
Okay, thanks. Well, anything to add about how your work intersects with supporting individuals who have these needs? And if not, Deanna, if you want to add.
I would say definitely. I mean, while we're very much focused on employment services, you know, those retention specialists oftentimes are partnering up with other nonprofits, you know, that can, you know, connect into housing or to other kinds of medical services and whatnot. And then, you know, one of the things that we really want to be able to do is just be a part of a much broader holistic solution, because at the end of the day, again, it's just not one thing. It's the whole multitude of things that, when, you know, pulled together in a very coordinated way, I think is where we can ultimately see, you know, people succeed to the best of beyond their ability.
Mm-hmm. And I was gonna say, through our funding sources, there is what we call mandatory requirements. And part of the mandatory requirements is that if you're applying for funding to do reentry efforts, there must be a connection to non-traditional providers that are providing housing, substance abuse, mental health services, so that we're providing that continuity of care from behind the wall into the community again. So within the funding sources, that is a mandatory requirement that that's a connection.
And when you say non-traditional providers, did you unpack that a little?
Because a lot of times when you're talking about correctional facilities and correction state agencies, we can connect to other state agencies or bigger agencies. But a lot of times in communities, it's the smaller nonprofits, it's the mom and pop shops that sometimes are providing services that individuals aren't aware of, that individuals are getting the services they need. Mentoring is one. Peer-to-peer mentoring from formerly incarcerated individuals working with other individuals coming home is a non-traditional service that has not been recognized by federal government or state agencies. So we're encouraging some of that on the ground level to happen and occur.
And Vivian, you kicked us off with this series of questions and answers about talking about the interconnectedness of criminal justice policy with other forms of social policy, including housing and education and workforce, and then we're landing on mental health. So what are some last words you have to say before we close out the panel?
So, yeah, definitely connecting with the best providers of those services in the local community. So what we don't provide substance abuse treatment at our location, We don't have a housing specialist. We don't have medical treatment. But we did a lot of work to find out who is the best provider of that service for this population in our local community, and developed partnerships with them and built into our student tracking system, our data system, so that the referral is not just, here's a phone number, good luck. Our referrals are, it goes into our system, we make the phone call, we make the connection, we follow up to make sure the meeting happened, and a reminder pops up on the counselor's screen. And we have trained all of our direct service counselors in trauma-informed care so that we can recognize when somebody may be having an issue, a mental health issue, or a substance abuse issue, or even, we've kind of scoped out potential domestic violence situations and intervened because we train our staff to look for those things. I really believe in small community-based solutions where people can develop positive relationships, where they're both giving and receiving something, rather than, that's harder work to do, and it's more expensive work to do. But as Diana referred to, it works. There are church basements all across the country that are having AA meetings every night, and people are staying sober. So we need to support that work. It's valuable, and it means a lot. The last thing I want to reflect, everybody, before you leave this room, on Diana's courage and Will's courage, and something that I've learned in the 16 years I've been doing this work. You're all sitting in this audience, and you're listening to experts talk about the work that they're doing to solve this problem of the connections between criminal justice involvement and poverty and other things. And unless I tell you that I spent 3.5 years in a New York State prison, you would not know that. And I say that as the last thought to get you to understand that people who have felony convictions don't come out of prison with horns on their head, right? We're just people. And many of us are trying to have a positive impact on our society. And we just really thank the federal government for really opening the door for that to happen in this administration.
Okay, so with that, I want to thank you. Join me in thanking our panel. You will now hear from CLASP Executive Director Olivia Golden in a few minutes, who will tell you a little bit more about, our work at CLASP. We definitely don't see this event as a one-off. This is the second part of a series, but we definitely are going to delve deeper into these intersections because our mission is all about lifting folks out of poverty and really thinking about the implications that poverty and all of these things have on not just poor people, but communities of color. So once again, let's thank this great panel.
Good afternoon. It's my job now, according to the people who organized this session, this extraordinary session, to summarize everything and make it all fit together and have clear next steps in about 15 minutes. So I'm going to try, but I think there's going to be a lot left to do afterwards. And I want to start, before I try to plunge into a few themes and next steps, by saying some thank yous, because this is really a hard day to close out, a hard set of acts to follow, given the extraordinary remarks, thoughtfulness, wisdom, courage so far. I want to start by thanking our keynote speaker, Nick Turner. Why don't we thank Nick? Thank you. Can we thank the extraordinary panelists and the moderators who kept them tied together and thematic and powerful as a conversation? Thank you to everybody. And then I want to thank the CLASP team. I'm going to read a group of names, but one of the things I want you to know is that many, many people worked on this. Wayne Taliaferro really conceived it and made it happen, and we're deeply grateful. But let me read the names. You can clap for everybody. Wayne Taliaferro, Dewey Pham, Anna Silensky, Tom Salyers, Andy Barris, Michelle Vinson, Sivan Sharif, and David Sokolow. Thank you all. And I also want to say thank you to the enormous group here, still here. I actually was quite prepared on a Friday afternoon to get up and find nobody left. So you're all exceeding my expectations. And to the hundreds on the web, and I hope thousands watching on C-SPAN will find out. I guess I do want to say that one of the goals we had at CLASP for this conversation was to figure out if we really could bring together an audience in our speakers and in our audience of people from all the worlds that matter to solving this problem, from higher education, from criminal justice, from workforce, from employers, from human services, from racial justice organizations, from community organizations, returning citizens themselves. And I feel as though we already accomplished that goal. We already know that there's a hunger among an extraordinary number of people to be connected and to figure out solutions. And so I want to say thank you to all of you for taking the time. So what I would like to do as I talk about what I heard and what it tells me and tells CLASP about going forward is talk about four big buckets of themes. The first one, which really Nick set us off on, is the question of how this issue of education, post-secondary education, work during incarceration and when people return, how does that fit into the much bigger issue of racial justice and of criminal justice reform and of mass incarceration? How do these things connect? Do the solutions we're talking about feel almost small in the context of this big agenda we have to accomplish? We had a lot of conversation about that during the afternoon, and I'm going to start by highlighting some themes from that. I'm second going to go to some themes about the challenges. Quite interestingly to me, none of the panelists really focused a lot on why this is hard. Everybody was so passionate, they focused on the solutions, but I want to pull out just a little bit about the challenges. Third, I want to go to policy solutions. That's our bread and butter at CLASP. I think it was a couple people, both Fred and Bianca, who said, yes, go ahead, change hearts, but let's get some things done. And kind of our orientation is we have to do both. We have to change people's broad picture, but we also have to get some things done. So I'm going to talk a little bit about what I took away from the conversation as potential next areas. And finally, I want to talk about next steps. So let me start with that question of how does this fit? We have, and I think Vivian talked about it with deep passion, so did many other people. Nick talked about the fact that we have an enormous mass incarceration problem with deep roots, yet we're also at an extraordinary moment of opportunity. So how do we take those big ideas and think about this piece and the way it fits? And I just thought we had some terrific answers to that. Wayne in his original framing, Nick in his remarks, many people on the panels talked about what research tells us of why this is such a powerful lever, that going to college, you know, has effects on recidivism, it has effects on your work, your contribution to the community later, it has two generational effects, we heard a lot about that, it has public safety effects, so we heard a lot about why, in practical terms, this is also a powerful tool. What I was very struck by, and again, Nick started this conversation when he said it humanizes people to think of them as college students, and then we heard a lot about that later on. I also heard a lot about why this is such a powerful symbolic approach. It helps people understand and make that bigger shift from thinking about them to thinking about us when they think about people as going to school. And then I think it was Bianca, or going to college. It was Bianca who said, and I'm paraphrasing, I may not be quite capturing it right, that you change everything else in the prison system once you create the aspiration to higher education. So for me and for us at CLASP, what was really interesting about that is that we think a lot about some of the career pathways and what you do when people aren't ready for that college education right away and how do you make it fit. And what I think we heard was the college education is a powerful symbol and driver of this work for everybody, even though not everybody is actually enrolled in it. And that was really interesting to me. And then I think we heard a lot in between. I don't know if anybody put this in words this way, but it was implied in what they said, that when you pick winnable battles, say Second Chance Pell, you keep people at the table. You keep them feeling energized for the bigger and larger and more time-consuming battles to come. And that's always been my belief. You want to pick wins that will take you towards your long-run big strategy. So I think we got some great answers about why this particular lever, why is it powerful, how does it fit. Second, the challenges. And it's interesting. We had a lot of conversation about the big challenges of attitudes towards people who are incarcerated, people who were formerly incarcerated, big attitudes about race. And we also had a lot of conversation about how you address those things. How do you change hearts? How do you change beliefs? And again, Nick started us off talking about the role of the videos, the role of seeing is believing. And I think it was Brant who had another example of that, seeing is believing, about solutions too. If you go visit something, a program somewhere else or another country where the mindset is different. I was reflecting as I listened to that about my own seeing is believing moments, many of which came while I directed the district's Child and Family Services Agency. I see colleagues and friends from the District of Columbia in this room, and that's the agency that's about child abuse and neglect. And what I remember very vividly, and what I think helped me be ready to think about these issues afterwards, is that I would see teenagers in the district, most often black teenagers, who had, I think somebody commented about the courage and dignity that you see when you get to know people who've been incarcerated or who are overcoming and changing their lives. Well, the teenagers that I knew were people of extraordinary courage and dignity who'd been through events that would have just devastated most people, right? They had, I think about a young woman who'd been sexually abused and who had testified, who had overcome that. But what I saw that really helped me think about the many dimensions of this issue was the way in which it was easy for these young people in their teens to start to be thought of as dangerous or frightening, even though I, who knew them far, not deeply well, not like their families, but better, saw the courage and the dignity in what they'd overcome. And so I think that idea that seeing is believing, that your ability to see how what other people have and bring, and your ability to see how systems have really curtailed their opportunities, there are a lot of strategies for engaging people personally that we talked about a lot. We also talked a little bit more systemically about the barriers. We talked about the barriers within the correction system, that officers are used to thinking about safety and how do you change their picture, and talked about going to a graduation, understanding the benefits for them personally. We talked a little bit less about the barriers within the higher education system. I would say that those of us at CLASP who think about higher education as it works more broadly for low-income students, many of whom are working, many of whom are raising kids at the same time, I think we would say there are issues about culture and mission within higher education that make it hard for higher education, many institutions, to successfully serve low-income people in general, let alone people who are incarcerated. We didn't talk as much about that, but we talked a little bit about that. We talked a little bit about, but again, not as much, about the culture and systems issues of the other ways we're not good in this country at creating stable lives for low-income people who are trying to move up, again, with or without this particular barrier. We heard from a number of people in the last panel, from Will, from Vivian, from others, about the range of barriers to housing, to childcare, to health that people have to overcome. So we talked a little about that. And we talked a little bit, again, I think there's much more to say, about how you knit together these different worlds to succeed in the end. I think about that from a lot of other work I've done about how you knit together systems. And I think about governance, I think about leadership, I think about relationships, and I think about money and incentives and data. And so we talked about governance. We talked about Pennsylvania got everybody together to do a plan. We talked about the federal government's cross-agency committee on reentry. Those are ways of just making it very formal that people have to talk to each other. We heard about leadership and about money in the California context, the governor's leadership, the resources. I actually think there's lots more to say about the resources. We heard some about the personal relationships that can move it forward. Didn't hear as much about data. We talked about research that could tell people this works, but not so much about how do you hold people accountable? You know, how do you figure out whether a school, a community college system is doing its job of providing education to those who are incarcerated and those who were? How do you collect the data to hold people accountable? So I would say that we started the conversation about challenges and got an early set of ideas about the solutions. Policy ideas are bread and butter at CLASP and one of the things we're going to go on to work on. So I'm going to give you a list of 9 that I wrote down, either because I heard them or because I thought of them. I wanted it to be an even 10 or an even dozen, and it might be by the time I leave this room. One of the things to just preview what I want to say in next steps is that we are planning to hear more from all of you, and so I think this is just a working list for us to think about. And as I said, my idea of how policy next steps fit into the bigger social justice and racial justice vision that so many people here are committed to is that policy wins are steps along the way that move you there. So we heard a lot about Second Chance Pell as a crucial funding stream to enable people to get access to that post-secondary education. So that's number 1. 2, we heard some about state financial aid choices and state financing, both inside while people are incarcerated and afterwards. Wayne and colleagues have written a terrific paper about state financial aid, which includes a lot of ideas that while they're not solely targeted at the formerly incarcerated are extremely relevant for states to think about. So we think there's a lot there. 3, we heard, especially in the last panel, about what we would call career pathways, strategies for linking together credentials, work opportunities, subsidized jobs, services like childcare, so that people can get to where they're going. There's not as big an unlimited funding stream there. We heard some about the workforce WIOA legislation, but we would love to work on ideas for expanding that and making it more real. 4, we heard a little bit of, again, mostly in the last one, but both the panels, we heard about what you have to do besides education and training and credentials so that people actually get jobs. We heard about the 45,000 barriers. We heard about ban the box and how you make it real. We heard, I think, from Fred about employer strategies, about Johns Hopkins that is a big employer and how do you draw them in. Again, I think we're very interested in thinking about what are the policy choices at the state, local, and federal level that can make that real. 5, I want to talk about money. I think at CLASP we're big believers that investing in low-income people, investing in young adults, investing in people in communities of color, that we've actually shortchanged that in many ways over the past period in the United States, and that it's really important. One of the questions I have for those of you who are expert in criminal justice policy is both prospects in the states and nationally as we move to reduce incarceration for redirecting dollars in the direction of education, employment, training opportunities. And there was some conversation about how big the savings might be. Coming as I do from the child welfare world, I'm always worried about overpromising, right? There's benefits down the road when you prevent incarceration or prevent highly intense services by doing a better job for people, but sometimes it takes a while for those to happen, so you can't always promise that they're right there and you can seize the money right there. But we'd love to talk about that. I think I'm on 6. I want to highlight the Affordable Care Act in the context of the mental health conversation. Huge opportunity, particularly in those of your states who are making that health care through Medicaid under that act available to everybody. 7, I think, maybe this is going to be just 8. That's okay. We're late. There was a lot that I think we want to think about that was about how federal and state agencies can keep the momentum going, right? There's big policy changes and there's medium-sized things. We'd probably think of those as executive actions, things we'd put before a next federal administration to just do without needing the Congress. Things like collecting data in a really good way to shine a light on who's doing this well, who's doing it badly, where are the gaps. Training and technical assistance. Somebody said that in the last panel. You said, I think it might have been Vivian, you said, figure out who's doing this really well and enable everybody to do it. That's a great thing to really commit yourself to. Research, we heard a lot about research and about how you want to know new things, but you also don't want to slow down moving on what you already know, but you can put research into key areas. And then governance and strategies to make sure that, you know, every corrections commissioner and higher education commissioner in the states gets convened and people get to know each other and there's ways they report together to the federal government. And I guess the last thing I heard that I'm thinking about how to keep in our policy agenda was the emphasis throughout about humanity, about heart, about voice, about ensuring that the ideas don't get disconnected from the reality of the lives of people who were themselves incarcerated, people whose families and friends and communities have been affected. And I'm thinking about that because I think when we talk about policy, we often separate that out and we say, yes, there has to be a powerful communication strategy so everybody understands, but we don't kind of think of the two things together. And I do think that there are some ways you can knit together the idea that part of this is about seeing those Mother's Day cards and thinking about who you know in your own life, and part of it is about moving the steps forward. So that takes me to next steps, where I want to close. And I think what I want to say in closing is that, again, Nick gave us a charge, which was democracy created this mess. We all have to commit ourselves to ending it. And Fred and Bianca gave us a slightly different version of the close, which was, let's get some action here. So it's both, let's go examine our hearts, and let's get some action. What we want to do at CLASP, first of all, we want to ask everyone here to make both those commitments, that you'll think about your own role as you leave here in terms of what new you could do, but also that you'll help us think about policy. We're going to get out to everybody with, at the very least, the video and some follow-up information and contact information so you can tell us if you want to stay involved. I think we're hoping that all of these relationships will lead to more work where we can bring our expertise to partner with those who know other things. And the reason for that, I actually wanted to close, again, in the spirit of keeping the people before our eyes. What I thought about when I thought about this panel today was an experience that I had now, I think, 20 years ago, when I was Assistant Secretary for Children and Families at HHS, and I was in San Francisco visiting a homeless youth program. And some of the youth had been in the juvenile justice system, some hadn't. I didn't really know particulars of people's lives. But I have a very vivid memory of a young couple. She was pregnant, they were holding hands, and they were telling me about their aspirations. They were going to buy a house, he was going to go to college and then to law school, she wanted to go into the medical field, and they just told it to me at great length. And the reason I remember it 20 years later is, of course, how incredibly unlikely that felt to me, right? It felt to me that here are these young people, they have the same aspirations that the children of all of my much more well-off friends did. They had every right to achieve those aspirations. But, you know, realistically, how could I say to them that that's going to happen? The reason that this work is so powerful and so important is that that's what it's about. It's about restoring the ability for people to achieve the aspirations that they have, that they deserve to have, and that the country will be way better off if they're able to fulfill those aspirations. Thank you all for being here.